Also.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to another season of Duhawk Football. I'm Hugh Maloney. As always, I'm joined with EJ Greenberg. And let's start this by talking off about last week and that big game against Central. What do you actually need to do today to repeat that success?
Well, Central has a potent passing offense. You know, they're one of the best offenses usually in the conference, and Nebraska Wesleyan is actually number one this year in passing offense. So Duhawks need to repeat that, what they did last week. They're able to stymie Central's quarterback. It's a big help. They didn't have Blaine Hawkins from last year. He's a Gagliari candidate, which you don't know is a D3 Heisman. So that was a huge key. Josh Kiefer needs to play as well as he did again. He had 15 tackles, 5 for a loss with two and a half sacks, and even a forced fumble.
And something that's good for the Duhawks is Joey Foley back for the Duhawks after being out last week with an injury. How big of a factor will that play?
Oh, yeah, Joey's a great, great ball player. You know, they were able to slow down their offense enough last week without Joey. Great passing offense, so hopefully they'll be able to do even better against the number one team with the addition of Joey back in there now. He had a little shoulder injury from the game where he blocked the punt, but now he's all good.
It looks like sound like Loris won the toss and elected to receive. They're going to give it out to their sophomore quarterback, Evan England, who's also been kind of a story in his own right throughout this season. EJ, what have you liked about the sophomore's play so far?
Yeah, he's third in conference in passing right now. He shows real good poise in the pocket. You know, he knows when to get out, when not to get out. He's thrown only 2 interceptions, 8 touchdowns so far, around like 800-ish yards, somewhere around there. So that's just a great season so far for the sophomore. You know, there's going to be a quarterback question coming in this year, the departure of Siggy. Some people thought it was going to be Devin Moore. There's complications with that. He's now a coach. So we'll see. Hopefully Evan England can continue his excellence today.
And a matchup that's always fun to watch is Evan England and Monty Brown. They've kind of developed that real good connection, probably both of them being sophomores, wouldn't you say?
Oh, yeah. Monty, I mean, he's a dynamic player. You throw the ball up to him, he's going to come down with it more times than not. He has the vertical. He has the speed. He has the hands. He has everything you want out of a receiver.
Looks like back deep to return for the Duhawks is number 11, Harrison Willis, as well as number 86, Marty McGovern.
Yep, Duhawks have so far this year kind of struggled with the return. I know Carter Cahill had a couple 3 or 4 muff punts so far this year, so I know they're trying to address that issue. There was one against Central last week, which I thought might have been key, but the Duhawks are still able to pull it out.
Yeah, the Duhawks were able to rally back and win against number 12 Central. Can they get another win to move to 2-0 in conference right here? And the Rock Bowl is back with football as we're underway for another Duhawk season. As McGovern mishandles the kick. McGovern at the 5-yard line, and he's, breaks away from some Nebraska Wesleyan Prairie Wolves.
Wow.
McGovern, which was doomed to look like it was going to be a 5-yard return, breaks it all the way out to, it looks like, the 23-yard line. And now it's what we are loving to see right now, is seeing Evan England's great play. Hopefully that can continue right here, and we're going to see what Coach Helminiak draws up for this first play.
Yeah, that's not a great start for Loris with the drop of the kick after we talked about there's been a lot of muff kicks this year, but Nebraska Wesleyan wasn't able to bring him down until he got to the 20.
Yeah, that just kind of shows the determination and grit that Marty McGovern has.
Yep.
Just not willing to go down after that first tackle. As they fake the handoff, England got all the time in the pocket. He's throwing it deep to Monty Brown. He's got him. The ball's a little underthrown, and Monty could not high point that one over the Wesleyan defender.
Yeah, that pass was a little underthrown there by Evan England. Monty Brown had a couple steps there on the two defenders. Looked like they had double coverage. They know the threat that the Monty Brown
had. I think if you, like you said, a little underthrown, if you would have let him just a little bit more, Duhawks might have scored a touchdown that first play of the game.
Yep. See the replay here. It's good. Oh, never mind. Live shot.
As Ty gets the ball and gets around 5 yards there.
Ty Bosch, the senior.
Yeah, and Ty's one of those guys that, you know, didn't have one of the biggest weeks last week, only run for 26 yards, but he had a touchdown, which is key in a big game like that against Central.
Yep, he'll always find the end zone. He's good for one a game.
In the formation, the Duhawks are looking like a little bit of two running back with Jamal Britt, the sophomore, in there, as well as Ty Bosch, as Ty gets motioned out wide. Evan, two-step drop back, kind of pushed out of the pocket, looking for Jamal Britt, and just threw that one away, let him a little bit too far, bringing up fourth down for the Duhawks.
Yeah, didn't have much time there. Receivers weren't able to get two downfield on the routes.
And it's going to force the Duhawks to punt the ball. the Duhawks punter, the hero from last week, number 80, Aiden Driscoll.
Yeah, special teams player of the week. Duhawks swept the player of the week for the American Rivers Conference with England winning offense, Kiefer winning defense, and Driscoll game-winning field goal and great punts.
Mm-hmm. And kind of Scott Talmadge was, you know, number one on the kicking roster going into that game, but he missed a field goal early in their game. Coach Hominiak felt safer going with the freshman as he gets a nice punt away here. Nebraska Wesleyan's going to fair catch that one. And it's going to be our first look at the Duhawks defense.
Be interesting to see how often Joey Foley's out there today with an injured shoulder. I don't know if they're going to let him be full goal or going to try to limit his reps. We'll see.
Yeah, because originally the other starter at cornerback was Mike Barber, number 10. But when we got these two deeps, I don't think they thought Joey would be able to play. But
no.
He's out here today, and he's going to play through that little bit of a roughed up shoulder. That's Carter Terry and Tristan Myers in the backfield for Nebraska Wesleyan. Shotgun formation, which I assume we'll be seeing a lot today out of both teams.
Oh, yeah. Both these teams love to pass the ball.
Oh! That pass kind of looks like the Nebraska Wesleyan receiver fell. Number 5, Matt Zarbinknicki.
It looked like the pass kind of got him a little quicker than he thought it was going to. And yeah. Zach Kemp almost was able to
pick it off.
Yeah,
I think Zach was a little surprised that that ball actually, you know, kind of got through him. Second down and 10 here after the incomplete pass by the Prairie Wolves. Same duo in the backfield for Nebraska Wesleyan in the pistol formation. They hand this one off to Myers. Myers making a couple guys miss, but Duhawks are there, and who else but Josh Kiefer starting off from last week, continuing it into this week, EJ.
Yeah, I think so. Kiefer, dynamic player. He can do it all. You know, we saw him make turnovers, tackles in the backfield, tackles when they're running the ball, passing the ball, he can drop in the coverage. Really a good all-around player.
And do you think Joey would be more of like a matchup guy receiver? Because I already see him for the field.
Yeah, I think they're
going to
last play. I wouldn't be surprised if they have him on the boundary most of the time. That's a strong run side. Joey's really good at going up and making the play on the run.
And Foley, top of your screen and press coverage as Nebraska Wesleyan dropping back to pass it. His first option wasn't there, and the Duhawks bring him down for a sack. It's the Duhawks' 11th sack of the season already in just the fourth game.
Looks like Sean Doyle and Blaine Jordan got in on that one.
Yeah, and we heard Sean Doyle pregame all the way from up here getting his teammates hype, and, you know, definitely a high-energy player that looks to swing momentum for his team.
Yeah, he started here as a tight end, so it's very interesting that he's been able to convert defensive moves. Already, I believe, his second and a half sack this year.
Yeah, Austin Newfield back to punt it for Nebraska Wesleyan. A little bit of a bad snap, but he's able to get it off. Duhawks can fair catch it with McGovern. Now let's see if this Duhawk offense can get going after last time going three and out. And that's something that I definitely know Coach Hominiak and the offensive coaches aren't happy about and definitely trying to make some adjustments there.
Yeah.
But didn't really have enough time with the Duhawks defense shutting them down, going three and out as well.
And it was a good play call, first play of the game.
Mm-hmm,
you know, the play action and got him. Just got it.
Just a little underthrown.
Yep.
But you'll have that, you know, maybe first home game, a lot of people here.
Yeah, a little
nervous. Could be a little nervous, yeah. Especially taking a deep shot off the way, but he had him. And that's a throw I think Evan England's definitely not happy about, but he can definitely make that throw and hand off. Make something around 3 yards there, which will bring up, let's say, second and 7.
Yeah, that's a throw Evan's not going to miss again, I don't think.
And I've just been really shocked by his performance this year, I'd say, because going in, they didn't know, you know, like you said, Devin Moore, something happened with him, you know, he's a coach now, and I heard rumors that Garrett Hutchinson was supposedly going to be QB1, but then they had a QB battle going into the season, and Evan England won it, as he underthrows, looks like Monty Brown again, as England's knocked down, that was Jamal Britt, number 44.
Yeah, hopefully this Duhawk offense can string together consecutive good plays. I feel like the only problem I would see last week is this, like, one major, like, good play, and then we'll see a 1 yard loss, 2 yard loss. We can see some more consistency out of the Duhawk offense, hopefully, today.
Yeah, with it being third down and a while to go here, Duhawk's definitely going to have to pass the ball. Looking like Nebraska Wesleyan's in a 4-3. It steps up, a dart to Marty McGovern, who gets hit over the middle but hangs on to it.
Good protection right there from the O-line. Give him all day in the pocket.
Number 17, Dominic Dara hitting McGovern over the middle, and that's just great concentration by Marty to be able to stay and hang over that going over the middle, probably knowing he's going to take a hard hit.
Yep, took the big hit. Didn't matter. He had one drop to get in the game. Won't have another one.
England, Bausch, and Britt in the backfield. Dogs hand off to Ty Bausch. Ty's got some hole up the middle and brought down up around the neck. No flag on the play.
A lot of Loris fans and players calling for a flag there, but
it almost looked like he just got him in the front pad and he's behind him.
I don't think he got the horse collar or the face mask. I think he just had the arm wrapped around.
Second and one here. The Duhawks are into enemy territory for the first time today. England with the snap. Hands it off to Ty, and there's a Nebraska Wesleyan player back there right away, number 57, T.J. Roble. And Evan England kind of gave him a shove, trying to help out Ty with a little bit more time, but that's all you need was the first down, so the Duhawks got.
Something about defensive players named T.J. in the backfield all the time.
Oh,
huh?
Yeah, T.J. Watt from Arizona Cardinals.
Pittsburgh Steelers, right.
I was right. Dang. Another handoff here to Ty, picking up around 4 yards.
Keep pounding the rock. You get three yards and a cloud of dust.
And, EJ, when people talk about staying ahead of the chains, what do they mean by that?
Stay ahead of schedule. Don't get behind schedule. So don't get yourself in the 3rd and 8, 3rd and 7 situations. If you're going to get a 3rd down, make it 3rd and 4, 3rd and 5, 3rd and manageable, you know.
On your first down play, what are coaches usually drawing up, you know, for distance-wise? As England drops back. He's got Jamal Britt out of the backfield for what looks like a 1st down.
Nice play action there. The play action is looking good so far today.
Yeah, that's almost what they've been running every pass play, it seems like.
Yeah.
Almost like an RPO kind of option. It looks like Crawford has checked in for the Duhawks, number 81, at the top of your screen.
You got the two St. Pat's guys on the bottom and top of your screen here right now. Marty McGovern and Michael Crawford.
Marty McGovern, Monty Brown, Harrison Wilson, Michael Crawford, the receivers in the game. As Evan England dropped back, good protection from the line. He's going to pull it down and run. England making a guy miss and wisely slides down there to avoid a hit.
Yep, smart decision right there. I was scared for a second that he's going to take a hit. We don't need him to take any unnecessary hits.
And it looks like it's 2nd down here, 2nd and inches. Duhawks on the Wesleyan 18-yard line in the red zone for the first time today.
All these receivers are great red zone threats, too. Great verticals, big guys can go up and box you out, get the ball.
The Duhawks elect to run it here. Ty trying to bounce it back outside, but that was a good tackle there by number 3, Ashton Kirkland, the sophomore for the Prairie Wolves.
Yeah, nothing going there on the original play design there, so Ty cut it back. Also nothing going on there. Although it did look like Big Sean had a nice pancake right there.
3rd and 2 here. The Duhawks going to throw it. England gets hit as he throws it, but he's got the receiver to the end zone. Looks like he's tackled just a little bit short for the Duhawks. That's number 13, Jaheim Haynes.
That was a great cut up the field right there by Jaheim and a great block there by Marty McGovern. Nice little screen pass right there.
Duhawks on the 2-yard line. EJ, you expecting a run or a pass for
this
first couple
first
plays?
Down, first down, you got to run it here.
The Duhawks do run to Ty, and Ty is going to keep those legs turning for a touchdown.
Let's go.
The Duhawks take a 6-0 lead here early and put them on the board.
Ty staying patient right there, waiting for the hole to open up, and he did. And it looked like he could have kept running forever.
Yeah, Ty, just one of those guys who's really good at keeping those legs going no matter what point in the game, as you see him talking to Coach Hilminiak right there.
Looks like Coach H is telling him to hit the hole a little faster, maybe.
Yeah, he almost did get a little bit set up as Scott Talmadge in to kick the extra point. This kick is up, and it is good. Giving the Duhawks a 7-0 lead here early. That's what you like to see, especially on family weekend. Get this crowd into it even a little bit more.
Yep, and the defense looked good first drive. Just keep the momentum going.
And they got a little bit of a rest here, kind of a long drive there by the Duhawks.
Great crowd out here today, too.
And this is football weather, too. It's, you know, no sun, but the temperature is around 62 degrees, and it's feeling good and just everywhere right now.
Nice and feels like Rock Bowl weather.
It does.
Feels good to be back.
back deep to return for the Nebraska Wesleyan, number 22, Victor Guzman, and number 29, Nate Torres.
Be interesting to see for the Duhawks if Scott's kicking field goals or if they still have Aiden kicking field goals now.
Yeah, what would you do? What do you think the coach's thinking strategy would be for that as you see Scott on your screen right there?
I would imagine if he's ARC Special Teams Player of the Week and kicked the game winning against Central, he'd be back out there for field goals.
Wesleyan run up the field. Good hit there by the Duhawks to stop him after a short gain, actually bringing him out around to the 25 is what it looks like from here.
I have to give a shout-out to cornerback Mike Barber filling in for Joey last week. He did an amazing job. He's a playmaker. That's what all these Lawrence Duhawk players keep saying about him. Mike Barber is a playmaker.
Yeah, Mike Barber as a cornerback is 6'3", so definitely can go up with those receivers and high point those balls. As Nebraska Wesleyan throwing it here as they're met by two Duhawks. Looks like Mason in their tackle as well as Jace Gwynn.
Just nothing after the catch right there from the Duhawks swarm to the ball. One of the big key things that most defensive coordinators will preach, and especially Coach Bauer.
Mason Morris, you know, he's kind of a smaller guy, like a hybrid linebacker, almost can play that safety and linebacker, yep. But he does like to hit, so be on the lookout for him. Number two right there on your screen. Nebraska Wesleyan under center, pitching out to the halfback. He's got some blockers. Makes a cut up the field as there's Mason Morris bringing him down from behind.
Yeah, Mason looked like Mason got sealed right there to start the play, but he quickly got off the block. And no one's going to outrun Mason on this field. Mason is literally Mighty Mouse. His size and weight might deceive you, but he'll pack a punch and he'll let you know he's on the field. He's strong, he's fast, he can do it all. Crazy athlete.
Yeah, and like you said, on that play, you kind of see the Duhawk player start shifting over right away. Yep. And there's a little bit of a misdirection counter that the Prairie Wolves are running.
Good blocking right there by Wesleyan. Let's use the outside.
Carter Terry in the backfield with Tristan Myers. Motion over. They hand it off to Myers. Myers trying to bounce it outside. He's beat Zach Kemp out there. Breaking a tackle as Zach Kemp brings him down. Saving him possibly a touchdown.
That good shoelace tackle right there. Got around the outside. That guy looked like he came out straight out of a jet cannon right there.
He cut up field quick and moving the chains as Nebraska Wesleyan on the Duhawk side for the first time today. Shotgun formation here for the Prairie Wolves. They motion over number 24, Victor Guzman. A lot of motion here from the Prairie Wolves. Pre-snap as it's a screen. Oh. But good play there by the Duhawks, number 22, Dawson Charlie knocking that one up.
Yeah, it looked like they had numbers out there, so it was a good job by Dawson to get his hands up and deflect the pass right there.
And how key is it for the defense on a screen to recognize that and cover the, say, halfback if it's a halfback screen?
Oh, yeah, it's important for the lineman. The lineman realizes it's a little too easy that he got him into the backfield. Immediately got to yell screen, retrace their steps, and put their hands up, try to get the hand on the ball.
Wesleyan under center again. The only other time there's a halfback pitch to the right side. Let's see if it is again, and it is. Duhawks swarming the ball, seeing that formation and know where it's going, but Nebraska Wesleyan still picking up around 4 yards there when it was doomed to look like a loss of one or no gain.
It was a good job by Jace Gwynn right there. They'll come up, blow up the block, make him cut it back inside where the help defenders are coming.
Tristan Myers, the running back on that carry. Third and six here for Nebraska Wesleyan on the Duhawk 35-yard line. Looks like a two running back formation here.
Wesleyan's loved motion so far. A lot of misdirection trying to confuse the defense.
Big third down here. A test early for the Duhawks defense. How will they handle it? As Tristan Myers is wide open in the flat. He's got one man to beat, and he shrugs him off, but he's pushed out of bounds by, I believe that was Jace Gwynn.
Right, I say it, some more misdirection there from Wesleyan. They have everyone going one way just to turn back and throw it to the flat where no one is guarding the running back out of the backfield.
Yeah, Tristan Myers was wide open there, and just like we said, Jace Gwynn making the tackle on that play and possibly saving a touchdown. Nebraska Wesleyan on the Duhawk 14. Duhawk's going to look to make a stand here, not allow a score. Myers motions outright. Terry dropping back, pushed out of the pocket, looking to sling it to the end zone. Overthrows his man. I believe that was Joey Foley on the coverage for the Duhawks.
Yeah, tight coverage there. He had a slight window there, tough window to get in.
Number 49, Caden Ewalt, checking in for the Nebraska Wesleyan, the tight end.
Wesleyan's had a steady diet of run plays so far for the number one passing team in the conference.
Second and 10 on the Duhawk 14-yard line. Terry and Myers in the backfield. Duhawk showing blitz. Wesleyan dropping back to throw it. Pushed out of the pocket. Looking to make a play in the end zone. Knocked away by Jace Gwynn.
Good defense there. No one was open. We had some pressure on him. Looked like, I believe that was Eli Dirtz and Blaine Jordan just kind of tripped over each other there, unfortunately. But the pressure is enough to force him out of the pocket and panic. Jace Gwynn's on the coverage.
Yeah, it was good coverage by Jace Gwynn. One of the best cornerbacks the Duhawks have, if not the number one. Especially with, you know, Joey being a little banged up.
Yep.
I also believe Andrew Heffel was in there as well for the Duhawks, number 43, a linebacker.
A lot of questions. You know, there's a lot of fifth-year starters last year on the defense. Guys have been here for a long time. Some people have to step up so far. They've been stepping up for the Duhawks.
That's what you like to see is the players stepping up as empty backfield for the Prairie Wolves as Terry drops back. And Joey Foley,
he almost had a one-handed pick
Joey
right there.
Foley almost one-handed intercepted that, and we would have just loved to see that. Really would have got the crowd into it even more.
I think he's a little unprepared right there. If he would have gone for two, I think it would have been an easy pick.
Yeah, I think he would have intercepted that. And that ball, like we saw with Evan England, that ball is a little underthrown, and both teams not able to capitalize on those underthrown balls. As it looks like Austin Newfield, the 5'7 senior, is going to kick this field goal for the Prairie Wolves. His kick is up and good. Giving Nebraska Prairie Wolves their first points of the game, making it a 7-3 ball game with 5:39 left to go here in the first quarter.
Yeah, that was a pretty good drive there for Wesleyan. They were able to confuse the Duhawk defense a lot, had a lot of wide open receivers off of motion. Just couldn't capitalize. The Duhawks were able to bend, not break right there. Hold him to a field goal. Good coverage there by the corners towards the end. Wait, get some pressure on the quarterback.
So if you're defensive coordinator Greg Bauer, what is those kind of adjustments you're going to try and make with your defense while the offense is on the field?
Well, it looks like the pressure's been getting to him. So maybe try to dial up some more blitzes and just tell your guys stay disciplined, stick to their assignments. There's going to be a lot of confusion. They're motioning everyone. Running backs out of the backfield, you know, just got to stick to your guy. Mm-hmm. Don't let the – all motion is just trying to distract you, get your eyes thinking about, oh, forget about your assignment, what's that guy doing running across the field there?
And it almost looked like on that last play that Wesleyan was running it almost another screen because it almost looked like all the defenders got in there right away.
Yeah.
So that kind of threw me off when I saw him throwing it downfield.
It did look like there were some guys left on block on purpose or something, but –
as Nebraska was in the end. Back to kick it off. Kick is up and it is away, and it's a good one at that. Marty McGovern with it again. He's at the 10-yard line. McGovern at the 20. 25, and he's brought down by Nebraska Wesleyan.
Tell you what, they might have to keep Marty back there all season. He looked real good back there today after the first muff.
Yeah, he hit that hole there and kind of, you know, didn't really burst through it, but he saw it and he tacked it, and that's what you like to see out of those kick returners.
He's had great vision so far.
As it looks like that ball is spotted at the Duhawk 27-yard line.
Tell you something, Hugh. I think the Duhawks are going to block a kick today.
Looks like there's a flag on the play. Looks like we're going to have to re-kick the ball.
Giving Marty another chance to get shifty back there.
And unfortunately, I didn't hear what the penalty was. Did you, EJ?
I did not.
Looks like we'll do this kickoff for a second time here. As the Duhawks move up their first line on the kick return. Move it up to the Wesleyan 45. McGovern and Willis back there on their own 8-yard line.
Let's see if they keep kicking it to Marty.
Kick is up and his way, and the kick to Harrison Willis this time. Harrison's at the 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35. Oh, and he fumbles the ball! As Harrison Willis turns the ball over on the kick return. That ball just got punched out of there on the hit, and that ball wasn't secured overly well, I'd say, EJ.
No. Yeah, it was a good return, good vision, good run. This guy secured a football. None of that matters. You can't secure the football.
As you see the replay here, he's kind of going at a good clip and almost broke that one away and just defender's helmet hit the ball, and that one punched right out.
Yep. Good tackle right there, but Dustin Harris would be right on top of it, so there's no further return by the Wesleyan right there.
Now this is where teams like to take shots, right, EJ? After, you know, a turnover like that, the defense maybe wasn't suspecting to come back out there. Yes. So would you expect Wesleyan to take a shot this first play?
Would not be surprised. Sudden change. You know, everyone's running on and off the field. They're thinking about getting a nice break. They'll listen to Coach Bauer, what he has to say. Got to run on the field.
Terry and Myers in the backfield once again for the Prairie Wolves as they motion over their tight end. Motion again here for the Prairie Wolves. So they hand it off to Myers. And Myers taken down by number 38 for the Duhawks.
And I think it's Brandon Phelps. Or is that Ryberg?
It's Josh Ryberg.
It's like Mike Barber's out there now, too.
It was a good job by Josh Ryberg coming out there, almost coming out of nowhere and taking him out.
Yep.
At the legs.
Josh Ryberg, big play last week with the interception and good return, too.
Prairie Wolves under center, flipped formation as last time. Looks like toss to the left. No, play action. Looking to air it out. He's got a man over the middle, and that's caught by the Prairie Wolves. What a play by Nebraska Prairie Wolves. Caught by number 25, Peyton Bartholomew. A freshman from Naples, Florida.
Yeah, good play right there for Wesleyan. They had a receiver. It looked like the quarterback was trying to hit the receiver a little more shallow over the middle, but he tripped up, and unfortunately for the Duhawks, that cost him as there's another guy get way more wide open downfield. Good passing, pitch and catch there, though.
As now the Duhawks got to try and make a goal line stand here against the Prairie Wolves. Two running backs in the backfield for Nebraska Wesleyan. Terry dropping back, looking for a play over Joey Foley, and they caught it. What a catch by Trace Laners for Nebraska Wesleyan over Joey Foley.
Then he let him know. He said he's too little.
And he said on his head.
Dang. It's great pass, great catch.
As you see right here, Terry's drop back, and right away you knew it was a high point ball, and it's just who wanted it more than Joey. Maybe that week off wasn't able to make that play.
Yeah. Great throw right there. We're seeing why they're the number one passing offense right now.
Extra point by Nebraska Wesleyan is up and looks like it is good. Giving them a 10-7 lead now as we near the end of this first quarter with 4 minutes and 9 seconds left.
Yeah, big momentum change right after that fumble, like you were saying, Hugh. Seen Loris had all the momentum there, holding them to a field goal after their driving. Great return by Harrison. See if the Duhawk offense can bounce back now and respond.
Do you think Harrison will be back out there? Or do you think they're going to put somebody else back there? It almost looks like Michael Crawford's out there.
I think he's out. It looks like Jace replaced Harrison, yep.
So Jace Gwynn and Marty McGovern back now for the Duhawks after the fumble by Harrison Willis.
Once again, this returning kicks coming back to haunt Loris this year. It's already four or five muffed punts / kickoffs this year.
Zach Finley back to kick it off for Nebraska Wesleyan here. Kick is up and away. And it looks like they're giving it to Marty McGovern. Marty's at the five from the Duhawks. Green has blocks, and he hits the hole. Gets that one up to the 30-yard line. Giving the Duhawks a good starting field position.
Yeah, they've all been good returns so far mm-hmm. for the Duhawks.
And the best one was probably the one before that, but yeah. just ended with the fumble.
This guy secure the rock.
And also looks like number 24, Kellyan Pritchett, checking in for the first time. Sophomore out of New Orleans. In the backfield, Evan England. So got a couple of sophomores back there right now for the Duhawks, as well as Monty Brown. Youth is kind of a theme that we're kind of seeing on this team.
Yeah, very young Duhawk team this year.
Evan England hands it off to Pritchett. Pritchett, oh, stays on his feet with a nice little spin move. He's brought down after a game around 7 or 8 yards.
Pritchett, you know, all the Duhawk players call him KP. He runs the ball hard. He shoots out of a cannon every time he touches the ball. There's a lot of good running backs this year for the Duhawks, so it's hard to spread out the carries, but let's see KP get some more today.
And when you think of the Duhawks running back, you know, Ty is kind of like a little bit more that elusive. Then you got Jamal Brew, who's more of like a pound-your-nose kind of guy. Evan England dropping back, gets his Marty McGovern across the middle, and it looks like the Duhawks are about 2 yards short of the first down, bringing up third and two.
I believe that's Owen Libby.
Owen Libby, the sophomore out of Wesley Chapel, Florida, excuse me. As Pritchett still in there on third down. Looks like Jaheim Haynes is the receiver at the top of your screen. Marty McGovern, Monty Brown at the bottom. So they hand it off to Pritchett. He's got nowhere to go. Met by Nebraska Wesleyan's number 94, Spencer Brooks.
Just stuffed right away there.
Fourth down, it looks like. Looks like the offense will be coming off the field. A little hesitant walking off there they were.
Yeah, they were thinking about it. Surprised to see the Duhawks running right there. I thought it was going to be a pass for sure.
And the offense is going to have to figure something out. Looks like Connor Durdan, the center for the Duhawks, has some words for the right guard, Titus Mullen.
You can just feel it. It feels dead inside the rock ball now. It was up and buzzing after mm-hmm. that touchdown.
It's a little holding quiet to a now.
Field goal. You can hear a penny drop now.
Aiden Driscoll kicking for the Duhawks. He's going to kick it to Victor Guzman here. Freshman punting it away to the senior. It almost gets blocked as, yep, that'll be yep. a flag and a first down for the Duhawks, I believe. And it will be because no matter what, it's fourth and three. It's either a 5 or a 15-yard penalty.
Yep.
It looks like the Duhawks are going to go back out on the field.
Wow. Major break there for the Duhawks. Major break right there.
There's defense coordinator Greg Bauer getting the special teams out over there.
If you're Coach... Yeah, if you're Coach Keller there for Wesleyan, you have to be so mad. He didn't really dive. He didn't give a full-on effort to block the ball. He just kind of lazily ran into the punter right there. You cannot have that. You cannot give this team a second chance. You're ready to step on their necks, maybe put them away.
And now this is where the Duhawks need to really capitalize on that mistake as they're in shotgun formation. Five receivers out wide, four on the left side. Marty McGovern, the lone receiver, top of your screen. Englund, QB draw. England trying to bounce out to the outside. He's brought down by a good tackle by the Wesleyan corner. Number three, Ashton Kirkland.
Yeah, that's a great tackle. It looked like Evan's going to have an easy first down, but he got off McGovern's block right there. Made a nice tackle. Good play call, too, right there.
Yeah, had the Wesleyan for sure thought that was a pass, and just good execution on everybody's part. How key is it for the offensive line to sell a draw on plays like that, EJ?
Oh, if you don't, you're going to get your quarterback killed, so it's on them. Oh,
as Evan kept on the QB read option, and looks like he picked up the first down, but tried to slide a little late there.
Kind of got tackled as he was sliding. Thankfully, nothing looked too bad right there.
As the Duhawks get onto the Wolves side again, second time of the game. Crawford, Brown, and I believe that's Haynes. On the left side of your screen with McGovern at the top and Bausch in the backfield. Duhawks hand it off to Ty. Ty met quickly after that handoff, looking like a gain of 2 yards there.
Duhok's steady running the football right now. It's going to be surprised to see a play action pass here somewhere else on this drive.
Wesleyan with four linemen. It looks like two linebackers in the box right now. As England dropping back. Oh, threw that ball just a little bit behind Crawford. Almost looked like it was tipped as well.
Yeah, just a little too much on that one.
Looked like he was kind of throwing that one into triple coverage a little bit with Monty Brown's guy kind of being behind him.
It's a tough window to get in there.
Yeah. Third and nine here for the Duhawks on the Wolves' 47-yard line. England bouncing in the backfield as Brown moves in motion. England dropping back. Didn't like his first read. He's got Monty Brown. I believe Monty caught that, and the officials are going to say, yes, he did.
Wow.
Great poise by Evan England there, stepping up in the pocket. First read wasn't there. Had the poise to step up, avoid the hit, and get it to Monty Brown.
Yeah, a lot of quarterbacks right there would take off and try to run for it, but he got his eyes downfield. Monty came back to the ball very good, made a nice diving catch.
England Bausch in the backfield again. Three receivers top of your screen as their corner blitz. Evan England keeps him off. England's going to tuck it and run. He's going to get out of bounds, and great play by Evan England. The sophomore continues to make plays for the Duhawks.
Yeah, I have no idea how he got out of that. That corner timed that blitz perfectly. You cannot time that blitz any better. Evan saw it coming, hit him with a spin move, kept his eyes down the field, didn't see anything, just picked up the first down, or just short of the first down off his legs.
And Evan saw that happen almost like right as he snapped the ball. He like turned his head and saw it and had the poise to spin around and get to the outside. As he hands this one off to Ty. Ty's just had nowhere to run today.
Wesleyan's been all over the running game so far for the Duhawks.
Looks like he picked up the first down, though. Yep, first and 10 here for the Duhawks. Looks like they're going to take this one to the end of the quarter. After the first quarter, Nebraska Prairie Wolves 10, your Loras College Duhawks 7. And EJ, what'd you like in that first quarter?
I liked how the Duhawks were able to move the ball. Obviously, Evan England stand out. He's an absolute stud. No one can stop him. Even when they get pressure on him, it doesn't seem like they can stop him. Defensively, we look pretty good. We're bringing pressure on the.
Good.
And we're bringing pressure.
And now, our sideline reporter, Adam Rodriguez. Adam, what do you got for us?
Yeah, thanks, guys. Beginning of the game, a lot of buzz down here. You can feel the excitement from this Duhawks sideline. Definitely coming off that big win from Central. They were amped. They were excited. Unfortunate fumble from Harrison Willis on that kickoff return. You can kind of feel a little energy get sucked out of them, but now they're kind of rolling back. Hopefully a good second quarter will come. We can get they'll get the wheels rolling. Back to you guys.
Awesome. Thank you, Adam. And I have to agree with that. You know, kind of driving here in second half. Nothing like starting that second quarter off with a touchdown. How about that, EJ?
Yeah. It would be a great start to the quarter, get the momentum back on our side. Like Adam was saying, that fumble was kind of deflated and gave the Prairie Wolves, a short field drive.
Yeah, and the Duhawks have been more of a second-half team this season. In their first three games, only scoring a total of 14 points in the first quarter and 13 in the second. So hopefully we put up a couple scores here in the second quarter and help ourselves out going into halftime.
Yeah, can't keep getting off the slow
starts.
As
England dropping back, pushed out of the pocket to his right. He's got Monty Brown. And Monty Brown catching that ball and some of the best hands on this Duhawk team.
Yeah, Monty Brown's a playmaker. Great job coming back to the football once again. Strong hands. Can't drop it no matter who's tackling him.
And that throws, it's not as easy as Evan made it look there, is it, EJ?
No. He had to put all his muscle behind it on the run, rolling out to his right.
Duhawks. On the 6-yard line here, the Prairie Wolves looking to get a score here as England hands it off to Ty. Ty run into his blocker, stays on his feet, and Ty is, the official going to say, looks like he's 2 inches short.
Wow. First try looked awful, looked like we were going to get stuffed once again, but Ty keeps those legs moving, falls forward.
That's what QB sneak here, you thinking, EJ, for the Duhawks? Is England under center for the first time all game?
Wouldn't be surprised to get on the ball quickly, yeah.
As Evan, he's going to spin it in there for a second rushing touchdown of the year as the Duhawks are going to jump back out to a 13-10 lead before this extra point.
Great job right there, just hustling to the ball to make sure the defense isn't ready. They know it's coming, but it's hard to stop.
As you hear, the Duoc fans kind of got into that as Scott Talmadge will be kicking this extra point again with England holding.
Hopefully this will get the defense fired up to get a stop here, fellas.
Scott's lining up the kick here. Snap, hold, kick is up. It is good, giving the Duocs a 14-10 lead. As we see a replay here of England's sneak, you know, kind of get a little bit of motion, maybe throw the defense off and just use his big offensive lineman, spins in there.
Good spin right there. Make sure you got in. Then everyone on the line has to let everyone know that you got in. You got to throw the hands up.
Unless, you know, defensive lineman like you played in college, you know, you don't necessarily
you don't
like that.
Hands
you
up,
don't
no?
necessarily like no. that. So, as you can maybe hear, the crowd's getting a little bit more lively. Chatter's starting to get back around.
Yep, we're right back into it.
I was looking at some of the stats from that first quarter. Nebraska Wesleyan only had 4 first downs compared to the Duhawks' 8.
They were getting us good on the ground, though. 6 rushes for 41 yards compared to 15 for 57 for Loris.
Yeah, and that's kind of been something the Duhawks have been struggling with a little bit this year is their run game. Only having a total of 349 yards coming into today. And they have 102 yards loss on running plays of negative as Nebraska Wesleyan will fair catch that ball and take it out to the 25-yard line. Guzman with the fair catch. As we see if the Duoc defense responds to that score they just gave up with hopefully a turnover.
Got Joey Foley and Jay Squinn back out there.
And it looks like Ryberg and Kemp are deep for the safeties.
Run heavy formation right here.
Pistol formation. Myers gets it on the handoff. He's got a blocker for him, but Duhawk swarming on him right there as I believe that was number 43. Andrew Heffel for the Duhawks making the tackle.
Yeah, great play there by him. Once again, I want to give another shout out to Jay Squinn, taking on the block of the bigger offensive lineman. Keep making sure that running back stays inside. You cannot allow someone to get outside of you as a corner.
Pistol formation, Terry and Myers in the backfield. Two receivers out wide, top of your screen. Terry dropping back. Looking to, he's got a man wide open, and Zach Kemp misses on the first tackle. Looks like Duoc's trying to peanut punch that one out of there. As they're going to throw a flag.
Duoc swarmed the ball right there. He just said.
Starting to hear some chirping a little bit from sidelines with the haze. You just hear somebody put your hands down.
Yeah, that was Coach Bauer telling the defense, though. Don't react.
As you can hear him saying to rip it and not punch it, so that's probably what the penalty is going to be about, maybe some unnecessary roughness.
Yep.
You saw some guy going in there for the punches.
Kiefer had a perfect one last week. If you go back and watch that game, perfect rip, like picture perfect.
So here's our official's call.
After play is over, as first and right, number 95 on the defense, 15-yard penalty, first down.
That 15-yard penalty going on Blaine Jordan, the senior out of Marengo, Iowa.
Yeah, and he's the one that everyone could see. Even from here, we could see number 95 going in there punching for the ball. Obviously, he wasn't doing it with malicious intent. He was just trying to knock the ball out. But still, he got a rip, can't punch.
Yeah, and I think if he would have done a couple times, refs might not have seen it, but he just going in there, just kept going in like he was Rocky or something.
He was a machine right there, yeah.
Terry and Myers once again in the backfield. First and 10. Play action pass, looking to throw it deep. He's got all the day. Completed over Mason Morris to number 24, Victor Guzman.
Yeah, had all day to sit back in the pocket and find an open receiver right there. Hard to cover your guys for that long, especially when you're running down the field.
Wolves marching down the field, and, yeah, like you said, it looks like Terry had maybe 3, 4, 5 seconds to throw that ball, and that's plenty of time. You're asking a lot out of your cornerbacks if you want them to cover for that long.
Yeah.
Terry Myers, pistol formation. They hand it off to Myers. He's on the right side trying to make Ryberg miss, but Ryberg tangled up enough to have some Duox assist tackle. I believe Foley and Dirtz were in there as well.
Yeah, Ryberg did enough right there to slow him down. For troops to rally, come bring him down Foley. See if this Loris defense can do what they did in the second drive of the game, hold him to a field goal here.
Second and 8 here with 12 minutes, 20 seconds left to go in this great first half of football. Pistol formation. The Wolves motion a man over, try to get him going over the middle, and he is met by Josh Kiefer. Kind of thrown off the Wesleyan play as he's going to just throw that one away to the sideline.
Was he in the pocket?
Looks like.
I thought that was grounding. I thought he was still in the pocket. I don't think he was outside of it.
Looks like the officials are going to have a discussion here. I personally thought he was out of the tackle box. But you never know with our angle up here.
Yeah.
As you see the officials on your screen discussing.
Coach H really wants one.
And they're just going to say third no down. Penalty and third down.
Yeah, he's probably outside. It was close, though, for sure. No receiver in the area for sure as well.
And before that play, Nebraska Wesleyan motioned over number 25, Peyton Bartholomew, and he was kind of going over the middle, and, you know, within that 5 yards, you can kind of shove him, and he was met by Josh Kiefer, and that, I think that's what threw off the Wesleyan play.
When Josh Kiefer meets a lot of things, the play gets thrown off.
As it looks like it's Terry in the backfield with number 49, Caden Ewalt, the tight end, 046, excuse me. As Terry pushed out of the pocket, Josh Kiefer bringing him down for the sack.
Let's go. Kiefer once again. He's flexing, letting him know.
Great sack by Josh Kiefer. Like EJ said at the top of the broadcast, conference player of the week on defense. As you see right there, good pressure there by Blaine. I believe that's Blaine Jordan.
Yep, and Blaine got help too.
And then Kiefer just wrapping him up and not letting him go anywhere.
I think that's number 3 and 3.5 right there for Kiefer on the year.
You are right, EJ. As Wesleyan going for a field goal here. I believe it's going to be a 42-yarder. As you hear the crowd getting into it, snap, hold, kick is up, and that one is short.
No good.
I don't know if the Duox tipped that one or if it was just possibly a bad snap or a bad hold, but that one was about 15 yards short.
Yeah, you'd have to think that either Duox got their hand on it or the laces were weren't facing out or something, because that kick was well short.
Because there's not much wind. Not much wind here today in the Rock Bowl, so wind definitely might not have played a factor in that.
Coach Keller wouldn't have tried that if he didn't have confidence that he was going to be somewhere close. If he thought that was, you know.
If he thought that was going to happen, they would have just gone for it. Duhawks now on their own 26-yard line. Jamal Britt, the sophomore from Chicago, Illinois, in the backfield. England dumps out to him in the flat. McGovern misses block. This JB gets kind of hit hard there by number 44 for the Wolves, Caleb Kies, 6-foot senior.
Yeah, good job by Simpson right there for the cornerback Simpson right there to get off Marty McGovern's blocker there, come up and make the tackle.
Yeah, that was number one, Carell Simpson, a junior. Duhawks got bunch formation out right as Monty Brown moves in motion. Pistol formation for the Duhawks. England gets a snap, gets it out quick to Jaheim Haynes. Picks up some good yardage there. Looks like the chains are moving.
This quick passing game, so hard for Loris to stop, so hard for defenses to stop Loris. So many weapons on this offense. Every running back has explosive ability. Every wide receiver has explosive ability.
Hand off to Britt. Britt trying to bounce it back outside, and he is hit hard by number 21, Onias Parks, the 6'1 junior out of Starkville, Mississippi.
Yeah, he got absolutely leveled on that play, but he bounced up like nothing happened. Can't let him know you got hit hard. You cannot let the defense know.
And that's what some people may call a hit stick, EJ. And how hard is it for, you know, players to get right back up after that? So they give it right back to Jamal Britton. Is it a little hard for players to get back up after that? You know, necessarily not hurt, more like an ego type deal? Or?
Yeah, you're just you don't see it coming necessarily, mm-hmm. you know, when you get popped that hard. But sometimes you don't even feel them, or sometimes you feel them a little later.
As they fake the handoff, get out to Monty Brown on the screen, and just drops that ball.
A little high there, but it looked like Monty still should have came down with it. See if the Loris offense is going to go for it here.
Yeah, as Monty Brown's not happy with himself there. England wants to go for it.
And they're not.
And they're not going to go for it here. It's kind of in that no man's land territory where you don't really lose much if you don't pick it up. Duoc's on their own 46-yard line, so yeah.
Yeah, I think they're probably thinking defense has had a big stop.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go out there and do it again. No reason to give him a short field.
And show confidence in Driscoll that he's going to maybe be able to pin him back inside the 20. Snap is away, and Driscoll taking a while to get that one off and almost got it blocked as Wesson's going to try and return it. As he makes a couple guys miss, he's at the 35. He's at the 40, making another man miss as Kiefer was going in for a rip there for the Duhawks. And that punt really turned out to be a punt of about 10 yards there, EJ.
Yeah, he made the whole first wave miss. Not a bad punt. Looked like he might have gotten tipped. Took kind of long to get it off. Made about seven guys miss that first time, and thank God the Loris was able to get back and make a tackle.
Yeah, it was Josh Kiefer kind of coming out from behind the play, not quitting on it, and making the stop. Terry and Myers, that familiar duo for Wesleyan in the backfield again.
Motion once again.
Terry dropping back, getting out to the flat on the right side quick. Duhawks going over there. Looks like he was tackled by number 20, Dustin Harris, the senior from Bettendorf, Iowa. Harris has that big club on his left hand there. Does that serve more benefit or harm for a defensive player, EJ?
It's kind of a great weapon to use when going for the ball. It kind of hurts really bad when you get hit with the club. But I will say this, I know Dustin's really bummed out they had to wear that. He had an injury last year that got misdiagnosed by the doctor. So he had to get surgery right before the season started this year. And unfortunately, he's going to have to wear it for almost the whole season when he could have not had to wear it this whole season.
As Myers bounced out to the outside, he's got daylight. Makes Harris miss on the tackle and jukes out Brett Bauer, sends him flying to the sideline.
Yeah, that was a great juke. I don't know if you ever seen the clip of Lamar Jackson in high school. You'll see it right here.
As this is what we've seen time and time again, is that run to the left side, pulling the guard. You saw him, number 66, Ben Holler. 6 foot 295, and just whoo!
He said, whoop! Put on the brakes real quick.
And he said, see ya.
Yep.
And you saw the big lineman there, Ben Holler. 295, 6 foot freshman, as they're throwing it back, throw it to the end zone. And that ball is loose. It looks like they're going to say incomplete.
Ooh.
Because it looks like the Duhawks, I don't even know if they came down with it, but it was definitely a close play.
Yeah, I think the refs are saying he never had full possession of it.
Yeah,
it looked like from here it was a catch and then a rip.
Yeah, it was number 10, Mike Barber, on the coverage that we talked about earlier in the broadcast.
What did I tell you, Hugh? They told me he's a playmaker, and he goes out there and he makes a play.
6'3", sophomore.
He's a transfer, I believe. He's from Luther, so I believe the last win was his first ever win in college football. And how about that coming against Central?
Yeah, it's thrilling as they pitch out to Myers again. Got a couple blockers. Barber kind of keeping him contained out there. Allows three other Duhawks to get over there and bring him down, bringing up third down.
Yep, got to keep containing for your corner. Worst thing you can do is let him get the outside because the guys aren't going to be able to catch him then. Going back to that Central game, one more quick thing about that. It's only the third time the Duhawks have ever won at Central. You go back to 2008, and before that, you have to go back to, I believe, like 1944.
And it snapped a Dutch win streak of, I want to say, 18 or 19 games in conference.
Yeah, like three seasons worth almost.
As the crowd's getting into it, as Terry drops back, throwing it up, double coverage, and oh my goodness.
Did he catch that?
They're going to say incomplete, but that was a beautiful throw, and it looks like the Wesleyan defender's down. Wesleyan receiver's down, excuse me. Number one, Trace Laners.
He just got that over Joey's head. I thought it was going to be another pick for Joey right there.
As you see it, double coverage and just over Joey's hands. And got to hope Trace Laners is okay for Prairie Wolves as he went down on that play.
That was a great pass right there. Oh, he's all good.
Probably, hopefully just got the wind knocked out of him.
Yeah,
there.
That's what it looked like. Yeah, talk about picture-perfect pass right there. Right over the defender's head. Couldn't, the only receiver could catch it.
Couldn't have placed it any better than that one.
Fortunately, Brett Bauer was right there to make the play.
As it looks like Nebraska Wesleyan's going to call a timeout. First one of the game. Coming a little late here in the second quarter. With 7:28 left to go.
They're going to talk this one over. And try to dial up something real good right here. We'll see if they go back towards Joey. Looks like they're kind of been targeting him in the end zone here.
Yeah, when, what do you think could be causing them to target him out there?
Well, they had that one great play, that one touchdown where the receiver just kind of mossed Joey, where only his guy could catch it. And then right there, it almost worked again. So it seems like the quarterback has a really good job at getting the ball where only his guy can catch it.
Under center, and only times we've seen these are on run plays for the Prairie Wolves as they motion over. And play action pass, push out of the pocket. He gets it away at the last second. And we're going to say that pass is completed to number 49, Caden Ewald. The 6'2 junior.
Wow, that's a good catch. There's a guy all over him.
I believe that was Brett Bauer, the safety on coverage there, and he wanted it more.
Yeah, it did not matter. It looked like Bauer got a hand in there and everything. Just was able to pin it against his body and come down with a touchdown.
As Wesleyan looking to take a 14-10 lead here. After this extra point. Oh, excuse me. 17-14 as that one is up. That one is good. Giving them Wesleyan a three-point lead. As you see right here, Terry's first look wasn't there, and he stayed poised and threw it over the middle, and just great catch there by Mason Morris.
Yeah.
A little bit of a size mismatch maybe that we talked about kind of earlier in the broadcast.
Yeah, good pressure there by the Dewhawks there, too. QB Carter Terry took a nice hit there from Hafel and, I believe, Doyle. Both got him. Stepped up and delivered the perfect pass to his receiver.
McGovern and Gwynn back deep again, and I assume that's probably what we'll be seeing the rest of the game and maybe the rest of the season.
Yeah, I would not be surprised.
Because, if I believe correctly, Jace Gwynn was converted over to a defensive back.
Last year, yep. He used first couple years he was a receiver. Last year, out of necessity, he needed more corners, moving the corner. He's done a great job over there.
Wesleyan's kick is up and away. Not a whole lot of communication by the Dewhawks as McGovern and Gwynn run into each other. And that starts the Dewhawks in a little bit of a deficit here, not even getting out to the 20-yard line.
Yeah, not great communication from the roommates right there. Couple mishaps so far in the returns.
Yeah, and you can almost kind of see that one coming from up here. As neither of them really looking at each other and both going for the ball.
And that could be a thing with Jace replacing Harrison. He just doesn't have the reps of Marty.
Mm-hmm. Dewhawks hand that one off to Ty. That one going nowhere once again. Getting about 2 yards, if that.
quiet once again here in the Rock Bowl.
Pistol snap, handoff to Ty again. He's got a hole on the outside. Ty picking up the first down and then some, as there's a rugby pile going on right now as the officials finally blow that dead.
Great run right there by Ty. That's what we need to get some life into this run game.
Yeah, and like you said, not a whole lot of life going on. Haven't been really able to move that ball, especially in that first half. First quarter. Only getting 57 yards. As play action pass here for the Duox. Englund throwing it deep. No flag on the play. It looks like that ball is probably uncatchable. Flag was thrown. Targeting Dwayne Emulis.
Yeah, he really launched that one down the field. I didn't think he was going to be able to get that much on it with the guy in his face, but he stood there, took the hit, launched it down.
Bring up second and 10 here for the Duhawks. Michael Crawford, the receiver at the bottom of your screen. Englund gets it out to Harrison Willis. Harrison making the guy miss and then brought down by the second wave of tacklers. We saw again there for the Duhawks another quick pass that we've seen so far and so much in this game. And, you know, play callers only really seen Evan throw it deep twice. Otherwise, it's been almost in the flat every time. As Evan jumping off to Ty in the backfield.
Once again in the flat. Picked it up. Let's go.
Ty getting the first down. And do you think at some point in this game that the Duhawks possibly going to take more shots down the field? Or do you think it's going to be a lot more in the flat like we've seen so far?
If Wesleyan doesn't come up at all, they'll keep hitting these little chunk plays in the flats. But if Wesleyan starts to come up to take away these chunk plays, you could see the Loris working in play action or pump fake to the flat, go deep.
Yes. Duhawks faked the short pass. He's got Monty Brown down the sideline. Monty Brown streaking down the sideline and brought down by the Wesleyan defender.
Shoestring tackle right there. Monty is a playmaker. That guy gets open. He runs yards after the catch. He has everything you need, but it does look like he is a little banged up here as he's running straight to the sideline, holding his elbow.
He was brought down by number 2, Kojo Atiboko, a senior from Grand Island, Nebraska. And like I was going to say earlier, you saw no safeties back deep for Wesley on that play, so a little bit of a fake screen, and you had him like we saw. As they fake the run to Ty to Harrison Willis. Harrison getting close to the six, picking up around 5 or 6 yards.
And a flag. It looks like it might have been a face mask there at the end.
As Monty Brown trying to maybe loosen up what's going on the sideline, jogging around.
Maybe just a cramp, hopefully. Yeah, good move by Harrison there, too. It looks like there's a defender waiting for him on the other side.
As the officials are discussing the call.
Is it holding? Are they moving back?
That's what Austin Nodder for Nebraska Wesleyan's thinking, and that's what I believe the call is going to be.
It's on Dwayne.
Yeah, receiver with the holding penalty there, and that's something that, you know, you're not happy with, especially on the receivers. You know, you don't really expect them to be overly good blockers, but you can't hurt your team like that with a 10-yard penalty.
Yeah, especially with a senior or fifth-year senior, Dwayne, out there. Hasn't gotten a lot of reps out there. It's not great for a holding call right there.
Duhawks at disadvantage now in shotgun formation. Read option. England's going to keep it, and he held that one for a long time and a great read and poised by both him and Ty to stay patient and get it past the original line of scrimmage here on second down. Bringing up second and 7.
Great, yeah, like you said, great poise, great patience out both those guys, knowing their job, knowing their role.
England throwing to Crawford. Crawford tackled at the 2-yard line.
Will be a first
flag
down
on the play.
Unless it's another hold, and looks like number 71, Big Sean's throwing his hands up in the air, so it looks like it might be on him.
Looks like they're going to call an ineligible man downfield. And I couldn't quite pick up the number.
I don't think they said number, but it must have been Big Sean because he was the only one on that side and he was throwing his hands up in the air.
as the Duogs hurt themselves again.
Gotta stop shooting yourself in the foot here.
England alone in the backfield. Five receivers out wide, four at the bottom of your screen. As they fake it again. And Wesleyan saw that play earlier, and they didn't really fall for it as much as they did that first time.
Nope. Looks like one of the defensive linemen, believe, or might have been a linebacker, number 57, JT Roybal. He was on that from the beginning. He saw the draw coming. You heard him say, quarterback, quarterback.
Bring up third and, believe, eight here for the Duhawks. Two running backs in the game for him with Britton Bausch. Crawford and Brown, the receivers at the bottom of your screen with Marty McGovern, the lone, at the top. They're going to throw it up to Marty into double coverage. And
got
he threads the needle.
Is he in?
They're going to call a touchdown.
Yeah! Let's go. Let's go. Threads the needle, two defenders.
As you see the crowd there in the pack stands, loving that touchdown. He threw it in between two defenders and just, I mean, when you say threading the needle, that is a video that will be shown. He just threw it right in between them, placed it perfectly. Good job by McGovern to keep the feet in bounds.
Marty, that great end zone threat. He had two touchdowns last week against Central. Picks up another one here. Let's go. We're fired up. Hugh's fired up. The fans are fired up.
We love our Duhawk football as Scott's kick is up and it's good. You see the replay here, and right away you knew where that ball was going. Evan didn't have a lot of time, but like we said, double covering, just threading the needle. Number 18, Jacob Grayman, a little slow for Wesleyan to get over there.
Yeah, that little play action fake there, you saw he made the corner turn his hips, so he had to return him, and he was out of position, and the safety was late to help over the top because of that play action fake. Great play call, great pitch and catch there from England to McGovern.
21-17, and we still got 3 minutes left here in this second quarter. Might be a barn burner today, EJ.
Yeah, 21 first half points for the Duhawks. Don't see that too often this year.
And if folks are wondering possibly if Evan England is that dude.
He is him.
He's that dude.
He is him.
Scott kicking away here again. Scott's kick is away.
Great tackle right there. Way to bring him down. I believe it is number 81 Crawford making the play right there.
The Duhawks three linemen out there, Blaine Jordan, Eli Dirtz, and Sean Doyle. Terry and Myers in the backfield again. Bunch of receivers out right as they motion over. They're going to throw it out to Myers in the flat, trying to make something happen. The Duhawks are all over that. No gain on the play.
Brandon Phelps sniffed that one out from a mile away. He was all over that.
Yeah, and almost looked like kind of the Duhawks kind of bit on that motion a little bit, but they had the poise to get back over there and, you know, shut that down.
Yep, good recovery. Some other updates around the conference. BV's down 13-21 to Luther. And Simpson's down 28-3 to Coe.
Yeah, and Coe, they're a good team this year, as a lot of the ARC is, as Terry is lit up on his throw by number two, Mason Morris.
Yeah, he had no time in the pocket right there. He just had to throw up a prayer and hope his receiver is going to be able to make a play. Fortunately, he's just a little over his head.
Yeah, and we actually have that Coe game this year once again, coming up on October 22nd. And if both teams keep playing the way they've started, EJ, it should be a fun one to watch.
Should be a good game.
the team kind of trying to get the crowd into it for defense to stand here on 3rd and 10. Foley in press coverage.
Looks like the Deluxe are going to bring some pressure here.
Terry pushed out of the pocket. And he's met before the first down marker by the Duhawks. Number 3, Brett Bauer.
Great tackle right there. Did not let him fall forward 1 inch. Did not pick up the first down. He was easily able to avoid all the pressure Dolores brought, but he could not avoid Brett Bauer.
Yeah, and former Duhawk cornerback Jack Foley got on his feet after that play as well. Loving that tackle.
Now the defensive coordinator from JV Makokuna High School. Shutout last game, 13 points, last three.
Because that punt was almost blocked by the Duhawks as good concentration there by, I believe that was McGovern, to catch that ball with the defender right in his face.
Hugh, I'm telling you what, they keep punting this ball. They punt the ball two more times. We'll block one of them. I guarantee it.
I like the confidence.
Loris's punt block team gets after it. They get after it.
Duhawks
drill here.
Yeah, I was about to say Duhawks got 2 minutes, 4 seconds. Drive down the field and put up another score here. Up by 4. Duhawks wouldn't mind a field goal here, especially with Wesleyan starting with the ball next half. England looking to air it out. He's got Monty Brown. Monty Brown beat his man. Oh, and he's tackled once again with the shoestring by Ashton Kirkland. And a little more air under that ball and be a different story. Monty'd have another touchdown on the season.
Wesleyan's quickly finding out you better double team Monty Brown because he's going to burn one guy.
Yeah, and like you said, Duhawks been going short, so safety's been playing back as they get that one to Jaheim Haynes.
Looks like there is a prey wolf down on the field.
But yeah, like you said, EJ, with the Duhawks only really thrown in the flat for this first part of the game, that has been open down the field, and we saw it there again.
Yeah, Monty's been open time and time again down the field. Dwayne got open once down the field too, so looks like these Prairie Wolves are starting to come up more in the flats. Be biting on some more play action fakes too.
And that's something Evan's going to have to maybe air out just a little bit more and not underthrow it like we've seen a couple times. So Wesleyan players still down on the field. Can't quite tell the number of the player it is.
Okay, I'm being asked by the fans. They want Joey Foley shout out right here. Battling through some injuries, battling through adversity. Number 98, Sam Jones, former Duhawk, fifth year, great pass rusher. Wants to shout out Joey Foley. The effort he's putting on, making the case for him to be all conference.
And it looks like it was number 21, Onias Parks, the junior for Nebraska Wesleyan, was the one that was down.
We also have Warburg versus UD today, so that should be another great game.
Incomplete pass there for the Duhawks, going for the deep ball to Monty Brown.
Yeah, keep feeding that guy the rock.
Third and looks like one here for the Duhawks. England Bausch in the backfield. Hand it off to Ty. Ty's got a hole. Ty met by 4 Prairie Wolves, and he stays on his feet.
Wow.
Bringing that one down to the 2-yard line, it looks like, with a minute and 23 left to go in the half.
Wesleyan just playing the pass right there. Evan England's been gashing him all day with his arm. Monty Brown not expecting the run, so Ty had a lot of space to go. And once again, not going down on his first effort.
Yeah, and I saw four Prairie Wolves meeting him there by the goal line. I for sure thought he was going down, but proved me wrong. Because Monty Brown's still on the sideline, still looking a little shaken up maybe, or just maybe out of gas. As McGovern at the bottom of your screen here, let's see if they target him or if they hand it off. They're going to hand this one off to Ty, and he bounced that one to left side for a touchdown.
In there, easy. Let's go. I like that.
Giving the Duawks a 10-point lead here before the extra point.
Loris burning down the field all day with their passes. Last two plays of the drive is handed it to the bread and butter, Ty Bosch. You know he's going to make a play.
Took Duawks about a minute to drive down the field there. Giving them the lead.
Yeah, quick possession right there for the Dews.
Talmadge and England, the kicker and holder here. Scott's kick is up. It is good.
There we go.
Giving the Duawks a 28-17 lead here. As we see the replay coming up here of that touchdown. Maybe we'll see it.
But yeah, it's been a good job by Loris. You know, a lot of times this year in the first half we come out slow, especially coming off a big win against Central. You know, you can see this easily being a trap game where Loris is going to be down early in the game and have to fight their way back. But now we have the replay. See England talking to Bosch.
Yeah, pointing at where it's going on. And then Duawks pointing to that right side and end up going on that left side.
Great pull there by number 67.
Good job by, I believe that is the number Titus Mullen, sophomore.
Great pull, sealing his guy, clearing the path for Ty.
It was a good job by Ty, seeing that that hole kind of got filled up, that Jamal Britt, the lead blocker, went through and bounced it outside.
Just under a minute here, Prairie Wolves.
Prairie Wolves got Guzman and looks like a Torres out there. As they squib kick this one, it's going to be picked up by the, maybe, by the Prairie Wolves.
Oh,
and
is that Loris football?
It looks like Duawks might Crawford have the football.
Michael Crawford said it's Loris football.
The Prairie Wolves kind of got lackadaisical trying to cover that one up, and they did remain with the ball.
Wow.
It looked like number 52.
And there's a flag.
Nico Jamali, a freshman from Staunton, Illinois, got in there.
Yeah, looked like should this have been a routine cover-up, but got away from the Prairie Wolves.
I don't know if they're going to be calling unnecessary roughness
here.
Are
they picking it up? Dustin Harris.
I don't know if it – do also have two number 20s on their team. Don't know if it was Dustin Harris or if it was Logan Warberry.
I think it was Dustin because I think he's on every special team. Talk about a gamer on every special team. He is a special team guy. I remember my freshman year playing at UD. Huge punt block that was returned for six in the end zone at UD. He was also in a cast then too, a club.
Terry in the backfield. Myers to his left. Terry, three-step drive. Getting out quick. Picking up a good 5 yards there for the Wolves. Not on their own 49-yard line. About to cross over that 50-yard marker into Duhawk territory.
Yeah, that penalty really hurts. Gets him that much closer to the field goal range.
Meyer lined up to the left of Terry. Terry, three-step drop, getting out quick. Looking to go at Jace Gwynn. Oh. And Jace Gwynn batting that one away. Nebraska Wesley looking to target number 7, Cole Symes.
Yeah, great coverage right there by the Duhawks. Jace just batting that one down. Wasn't able to fully turn to get two hands on it, but we'll take one
it
hand
It almost
all
looked
day.
Like his other hand was kind of being held and wasn't able to get it up there maybe.
Yeah.
But Jace Gwynn, second time being targeted today, I believe, and it's second pass deflection. Terry, quick drop back, looking to throw it, and overthrew his man there with Brett Bauer, looking to lay the hit there.
Yeah, if he would have caught that, I don't know if...
it was number one, Trace Landers.
Yeah, I don't know if Trace Landers would have been playing the rest of that game. Yeah, that was set up for a real big hit right there if he came down. He would have been in midair, and Brett would have met him right when he caught the ball at the high point.
And the key thing there is that stops the clock for the Duhawks, not even having to burn a timeout. They'd have around, after this kick, I'd assume it'd be around 40-ish seconds with three timeouts to drive down the field. So maybe look to put up another score. As the kick is away, it looks like they're just going to kick this one out of bounds. And hopefully, oh.
Yeah, Duhawks might just be out the half now. Good punt right there.
Didn't know if that one might have taken a Duhawk bounce in the end zone, but it looks like it was checked up by number 38, Max McClatchy, a freshman from Lincoln, Nebraska. Ball is downed inside the 10 at the 8-yard line, so a great punt there by Austin Newfield. As the sun's starting to come out at the Rock Bowl, temperature on the field might start picking up a little bit.
Fortunately for us, we have plenty of people from Florida and Louisiana who are used to this weather. Does not look like Lors is going to knee it out.
So Evan gets the snap, fakes the pass, kind of drew Nwesleyan off a little bit with it, and Ty is met by three Prairie Wolves.
Yeah, it took a big hit right there.
A gain of around three there for Ty, bringing up second and seven. 10 seconds here, and it looks like both teams are content with just letting this one go into halftime. After the first half, Nebraska Wesleyan Prairie Wolves 17, your Lors College Duhawks 28. And EJ, what's something you liked seeing from our boys that first half?
I love the offense mixing it up, being able to run the ball, not looking so good in the first quarter, really running the ball. But second quarter, it opened up. Monty Brown is open every time, and even if he's not open, he is. He is the D3, Justin Jefferson.
And what is some of the things maybe you'd switch up if you were the Duhawks right now?
I'd say this is a passing game. Keep communicating on defense. The kick returns, we got to tighten up on those, communicate between those two. And, yeah, other than that, good half. Let's keep it up.
And just what does Nebraska Wesleyan have to do to possibly come back into this game?
Well, I would suggest double covering Monty Brown, first of all. Keep getting pressure on England. I feel like when they get pressure on England, they got to keep him in the pocket, though. When he gets out of the pocket, that's trouble. He's been able to avoid their pressure and get into the pocket. Then offensively, their passing games look good. They just got to do it, keep going. I think they'll be just fine. Running game, we'll see.
Awesome, man. Me and EJ will be back at halftime. Stay tuned for the second half. Should be a good one. Hello and welcome back for the second half of football here at the Rock Bowl. Just a refresher, your Lors College Duhawks 28, Nebraska Wesleyan Prairie Wolves 17. As the Duhawks have entered back out into the field, looking to cap off a strong first half with a win here and move to 2-0 in conference, and I believe 2-2 overall after starting off 0-2. And, you know, a connection that we have seen a lot today has been between Evan England and Damani Brown. And, you know, for more on Damani Brown, we're going to throw it down to Adam Rodriguez. Adam, what do you got for us?
Yeah, thanks, guys. And absolutely, Monty Brown and England definitely have a great connection going. Monty's been targeted 7 times for 4 catches and 107 yards. Most targets for any Duhawk receiver. Definitely keep watching that connection as it builds up over and over throughout this game. With Monty, we saw him come off the field after that long reception of 40 yards. Come off, looked at his right forearm, a little injury. Seemed to be good. He went back on for a few more plays right after that. So keep watching for that connection, and I'm sure we're in for a good victory here for the Duhawks. Back to you guys.
Awesome. Thank you, Adam, for that great report. And, yeah, like you said, Damani Brown and Evan England, they have that connection. That's something that's going to only build over time, both sophomores, so they definitely gel really well together. And, EJ, what are some of the key stats that stuck out for you in that first half of football?
Yeah, we looked like Ty. I mean, if you had to guess, I wouldn't have guessed this, but 15 for 73. First quarter really was a struggle fest, but then he had those three big runs in the second quarter to be able to open it up. Evan has 7 carries for 43 yards. JB 2 for 9. KP 2 for 6. As you see, Russ receiving, we got Jaheim has 3 catches for 36. Marty has 2 catches for 39 and a touchdown. And JB has 2 catches for 11 yards. Evan England having another nice day for the Duhawks, 14-21, 199 yards and 2 touchdowns, so just under 200 yards at halftime. We'll take that every time. And then for Wesleyan, we have Tristan Myers going for 9 carries, 86 yards, so good day on the ground for him, averaging almost 10 yards a carry. Carter Terry, 10 for 21, 127 yards, 2 touchdowns. Not the best completion percentage, but has had some couple nice touchdown passes. Receiving-wise, Trace Leonards has 2 catches for 12 yards and a touchdown, and Tristan Myers has 2 catches for 21 yards. Defensively, for the Duhawks, we have 6 total tackles for Mason Morris. No surprise, he leads the Duhawks coming into this game with 28.5. Kiefer, once again, has 3 total tackles and a sack. And then for the other side of the ball, for Wesleyan, he has 6 total tackles from Caleb Keys and 5 total tackles from TJ Roybal.
Yeah, and it's almost like the energy has kind of come back into the Rock Bowl after that first half. You know, people were able to go to the concession stand, get some food, get something to drink, and everybody's ready for the second half to get underway, and the energy is just high right now.
Yeah, Wesleyan's going to come out on offense here to start the half. They're going to try and make a statement, probably sling the ball a little bit more, maybe run the rock to get average of 10 yards a carry.
Yeah, and especially expect them to sling the ball, like we said earlier in the broadcast. Carter Terry leading the conference in passing with 133 attempts. That's 7 less than Evan England came in with today, but Wesleyan going to have to air it out in the second half as they're going to fair catch that ball, and Duhawk defense going to come out onto the field.
At half, BV trails Luther 19-21. Luther 0-3 this year, didn't win a game last year, so that could be a big win for Luther, finally getting back in the win column. And Co, 12 minutes left in the third, leads Simpson 41-3.
Yeah, and looking at some other stats for the Duhawks, Damani Brown, currently third in conference in receiving yards and already at the 107 yards in that first half. He may have jumping up to second with the person in first being Ryan New from Central at 487 yards. As Wesleyan hands that ball off to start the second half, gets around 4 yards before he's met by the horde of Duhawks.
Duhawks is swarming to the football right there.
Zach Kemp with the tackle.
See if Nebraska Wesleyan keeps up with this motion. They loved it in the first half. Seemed to work for him pretty well.
Shotgun formation with Myers back behind his left. Terry, quick drop back, getting out into the flat to his receiver. Not going in.
Oh! The Duhawks super score!
Yeah!
Touchdown, Duhawks!
Go! Josh Kiefer, the ARC Defensive Player of the Week last week, gets another scoop and score for a touchdown for the Duhawks.
Who forced it? I think that might have been Jace Gwynn over there. Had to be some cornerback, and I believe Jace Gwynn was on that side.
Energy is just filling up the Rock Bowl right now.
Let's go. Have a season, Josh Kiefer. Have a season.
The crowd and everybody's into this game now as Big Sean Core is just running out there for the kick.
The pride of East Dubuque, Josh Kiefer.
And that's what the Duhawks kind of needed coming out of that halftime, you know. Maybe get out to a high energy play as Scott's kick is up and good, and a scoop and score will definitely do that, especially with your leader Josh Kiefer being the one to get that touchdown.
Yeah, that's a killer for Wesleyan coming out of half.
As you see the replay here, and yeah, it looks like you were right. Jace Gwynn knocking that one away, and Kiefer just scooping score and taking that one to the house. And then Josh was just running all around the field after that one back to the sideline.
He said, look what I found. what an electric start to the half. Let's go. Defense is probably fired up to get right back on the field and get another one.
And that was just the Duhawks' third fumble recovery of the year. And also the third fumble that they've caused as well. So, for as good as our defense is, you know, three fumbles in four games is pretty good.
Yep.
It's a pretty good rate.
And Kiefer, involved with two of those. Nose always around the football.
As the Duhawks have jumped out to a 35-17 lead here at the start of the second half. Scott lining the kick up. It's up and away. Wesleyan's going to fair catch that one again. It sounded like somebody wanted offsides over there.
Yeah, they did call for an offsides. Looks like Kiefer's going to get a break this play. Well deserved.
Nebraska Wesleyan starting this possession on their own 25-yard line. Carter Terry and Tristan Myers, your duo in the backfield for the Prairie Wolves. Pistol formation. One receiver at the top of your screen, two on that line. Run formation, they hand it off. As the Duhawks are back there early, Eli Dirtz trying to make a tackle, and Myers getting around 3 yards on a play that should have maybe lost him two.
Yeah, good job by the running back there to fall forward. There's a plethora of Duhawks in the backfield right away. Messing up that play.
It looked like Andrew Hayful was the first one back there to meet Myers, and unfortunately wasn't able to bring him down with that arm tackle. Shotgun formation. Terry trying to diagnose what the defense is in. Maybe thinking blitz here. Duhawks only send four. Terry's got plenty of green turf to run in front of. He's going to run out of bounds before Joey Foley can hit him.
Yeah, he was watching number seven right there for Wesleyan as Joey and Phelps were giving him a double team. Or it might have been Rydberg, actually. Yeah, Joey and Rydberg double team. His eyes went straight there, and we saw Rydberg helping on the double team. He saw there was an open spot for him to run, and he took it.
Yeah, and after that play, he kind of saw number seven for the Ducks, Joey Foley, number seven for Nebraska Wesleyan and Cole Symes kind of chirping at each other after that one, so... Maybe something to look out for. Maybe this.
Wonder if he's saying, yeah, you need a double team me or something, or maybe they're arguing who's the real number seven.
Pistol formation. They're going to hand it off again. He's met right away by Sean Doyle. Couldn't bring him down, but there's other Duhawks there to secure that tackle.
All over that play. Way to blow it up, Sean Doyle.
It looks like Brandon Phelps was the second one there to kind of bring him down.
Doyle needs a sub. He's limping off after that play. Looks like number 99, Marcus Lampley's going to come on for him. Ball spotted at the 35, second down.
Yeah, Sean immediately going over to sit down and talk to the trainer on the bench.
I believe some of his knee.
Terry and Myers in the backfield again. Motion over, fake the jet sweep as he's just going to throw that one at the feet of the receiver, get the incomplete pass.
Yeah, nothing cooking. This Duhawk defense has been swarming to start the second half. He had no time to pass right there.
As Josh Kiefer checks in for this big third down here.
And I have to imagine that Wesleyan's going to keep passing the ball, being with the score what it is. So Duhawk's going to keep bringing pressure. It's going to be a long day for his quarterback.
And is Coach Bauer one of those defensive coordinators who likes to send the pressure or kind of drop back and let the DBs do their work?
I think he's pretty mixed. I think he's a really well-balanced. He'll do exactly what he thinks he needs to do, get the win. He's not going to sell or stand by one philosophy necessarily.
Bunch of receivers at the top of your screen. Terry looking to air it out here on third and long. Thrown over the middle to Myers. That one's incomplete. I believe that's Brandon Phelps with the deflection.
Nothing going there.
Nobody open. And he kind of, I think Terry's starting to get a little skittish back there. He's already been pushed out of the pocket a few times early in the second half and a couple times in that first half. So maybe getting a little impatient back there and trying to force something that wasn't there.
You know, I think Terry's starting to not have fun right now. I think the last two drives have not been fun for him.
Yeah, turnover and then fourth down, a quick drive here. Putting back to Marty McGovern. Low snap. At Paul.
Don't get hit.
As it takes a Prairie Wolves roll in. Looks like there's some extracurricular on a block there. All right, number 22 for the Duhawks.
Dawson Charlie.
Dawson Charlie on number 34. Eli Makowski.
And Dwayne Emelis and Dawson Charlie had a great double team. They just put that guy right into the dirt right there. And he was, we almost got to that punt. Like I said, we were there, right there almost, again.
Yeah. It's Evan England and Ty Bausch in the backfield here as the Duhawks' first offensive drive of the second half. Hand it off to Ty. Ty getting a nice solid gain of 5 yards there. Pistol formation again. Duhawks on a little bit of a hurry-up offense here. Showing a screen to Marty McGovern, who's close to that stick marker. It looks like the officials are going to give him the first down.
Duhawks just rolling all cylinders here to start the second half. Love to see it. Opener in the Rock Bowl.
And does Coach Helminiak, is he the play caller for the offense? Or
Coach Olson is the offensive coordinator.
As Ty runs it here, hits the hole and almost took that one just a little bit farther.
Just got tripped up there at the last second.
Gained around 8 yards, making it a second and very manageable. A hurry up again here for the Duhawks. Evan looking to throw underneath to McGovern. McGovern wrapped up by number 3, Ashton Kirkland from behind.
Looked like he got him right at the line of scrimmage. Looked like they went a little faster. I don't believe if all the offense is really ready for that snap.
Yeah, they seem kind of a little surprised by it, a little flat-footed.
This fast tempo has seemed to throw the Prairie Wolves off today so far.
Bausch motions out to the flat. Evans looking at Monty the whole way. And looks like the official is going to mark it as a first down. Great awareness by Damani Brown there to know where the sticks are and pick up that first down.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Third down, you always have to be aware of where the sticks are. Make sure your route is not a yard short.
Evan fake throwing it to Harrison Willis. Push out of the pocket left. Gets it to Harrison Willis, who's open in the flat that whole possession.
Nice little shifty move there. Good pass protection right there from 71, Big Sean.
And, you know, it was kind of like a fake screen to Harrison there, but Wesleyan still decided not to cover that. And what do you think that was? You think that was just miscommunication?
Nah, I think that's what Loris wanted to do, is come up on the fake pass so they could hit a home run deep. But good discipline by there by the Prairie Wolves.
Jamal Britt just checked in for the Duhawks. They're going to hand it off to him, trying to make something happen. Gets back to the line of scrimmage.
It's fast-paced, Loris offense.
Bringing up, looks like, around 3rd and 5 here for the Duhawks. On the Prairie Wolves' 38-yard line. England, quick drop back. Trying to get out to Jamal Britt in the flat by the sticks, and that pass was knocked down. And looks like
they're probably going. Are they going to go for it? I think you had.
Looks
are they gonna
like
punt?
They're going to.
Oh, they are going to
punt the ball here.
Hopefully, they can pin him back here.
And EJ, in this situation, would you be? Because I feel like a punt's not going to do you a whole lot here. I feel like,
yeah,
going for it would maybe just possibly be a. I don't know if I'd say a better option, but
yeah,
you're like no man's land.
Yeah,
right,
this
here
is no man's land. You can go either way. He punts it too far. It's going to end up being like a 15-yard punt because it would come back to the 25, but this looks like it might be a good one. A little too much on it.
That punt there by the freshman, Aiden Driscoll, bounces in to the end zone, bring the ball out to the 20-yard line.
I think the score has a lot to do with that, though, right there. If it was a little closer of a game, they probably would have gone for it.
Mm-hmm.
But being up by 3 scores right now, I think they're comfortable putting, especially the way this defense has been playing.
Yeah, and this defense has just been led by not just this game but all season. Josh Kiefer, just holding down the middle and always making plays.
An all-conference selection this year. He's almost a lock to get it again this year.
Wesleyan under center. Been doing a lot of play action out of this after running it the first three times in this formation. Play action again here for Terry. Terry looking to air it out. And diving catch, no good. Joey Foley kind of got beat there. Maybe thought he had some help over the top, but luckily enough for the Duelocks, they couldn't connect on that play.
Yeah, it looked like he got tripped up on Joey's legs there a little bit too. That also helped out. Another great pressure there by the Duelocks. Just almost right away he was in the backfield, forcing Terry to roll out.
Number 56, Jonah Clark, a freshman from Wayland, Iowa, has checked into the game here. Terry alone in the backfield. Quick drop back, trying to get out quick. Oh, and that hit off Joey Shoulder's right shoulder, Joey Foley's right shoulder, excuse me.
Great play by Joey right there. It looks like they tried to run a real pick play, but Joey stuck right tight on his man. You have to do if they're going to run that play, otherwise he's going to be wide open every time. He got a hand on it.
And that ball had some zip going in there, too. He was not holding back on that throw. But you can't really do that, though, in those kind of tight areas, can you, EJ?
No, if you throw a lollipop in a tight window, it's going to be an interception every time.
Third and 10 here for the Prairie Wolves. Haven't been able to get anything going so far this second half.
They've not been able to get anything cooking.
You see Mike Barber at the bottom of your screen. They throw it in. Oh, intercepted by Joey Foley!
Let's go!
I believe that was number 36, Brandon Phelps, whose hands it went through.
Yeah.
And EJ Greenberg's roommate, Joey Foley, with the interception, first game back.
Yep, that's my best friend right there.
As you see the replay here, Terry kind of throwing it quick like he has been this whole second half.
Great pressure from Blaine. Just off the receiver's hand. Phelps knocked him down, and Joey's right there to feed on their mistake. Let's go.
Number one, Trace Laners was the intended target for that and just went through his hands, and looks like it was a flag.
Oh, no flag.
No.
Just want to make sure he's ready to go. Thank you, ref. No, as a fellow ref, I feel that. Oh, wow, that's a killer. That is a killer.
That was on the receiver who the ball went through their hands, Trace Laners. So maybe a little bit of frustration on his part and maybe a little bit of chirping going on that caused him to get that 15-yard penalty.
Yeah, he probably wasn't happy about Phelps going up and making a play, but if Phelps didn't do anything wrong, he just went up and made a play.
Looks like KP in the backfield. Going to hand it off to him. Keeps those legs turning, and Pritchett picks up close to 5 yards on that run.
Multiple times today, it looks like Nebraska Wesleyan's had Loris running back stud in the water, but they have kept their legs turning and falling forward.
England handed off to Pritchett again. Pritchett about 5 inches short of that first down marker, bringing up third and inches.
Oh, flag.
Is that a late flag? Looks like it's on Nebraska Wesleyan's
they did
coach,
the
maybe?
Sideline warning
I
or
saw
something?
The ref point at.
He did point over there, yeah.
Their head official will tell us right here.
Yep.
So what kind of provokes a sideline warning usually?
You can't be past the 25. So see how they're all past 25?
Oh, yeah.
None of them are supposed to be. Maybe the coach can be past there, but none of those players are supposed to be past there. And then I don't think the coach is supposed to go inside either the 20 or the 15.
Okay. And that would be a 15-yard if they don't get that corrected.
I do believe so. I do believe it's 15 yards.
England handing off to Pritchett. Pritchett, turn those legs.
He's
for
in.
A touchdown.
KP.
Kelly and Pritchett with his touchdown. Give the Duelocks an even bigger lead and extend that one. Duhawks are just rolling. And that was his first touchdown of the year, and I believe that was his first ever touchdown in college as well.
Yeah. That's awesome. You love to see that. All the way from Louisiana, too.
Yeah. Huge touchdown, and it's always something you like to see, players getting those first touchdowns. England gets the snap. Scott's kick is up, and oh, that one went through.
It looked like it might
have been a spinner, yeah. You see right here the replay of Pritchett just reading the hold and just keeping those legs going and spinning him backwards to get in there.
Yeah, it's great blocking. He didn't get touched till about like 3 or 4 yards past the line of scrimmage, and that's enough for him to just drive the defender into the end zone. This Nebraska Wesley team just looks defeated right now. On the sideline, they look flat. Players walking out on the field, they look flat. You know, most of the time you never see these guys walking on the field. You want to see them jog at the very least.
Duhawks have jumped out to a 42-17 lead here.
And I can imagine Loris is probably going to keep it on the ground here for most of the rest of this half. Just try to chew out some more clock. And Nebraska Wesleyan, I would imagine, still going to try to pass the ball, but they might get the quarterback killed, by the way, so I'm going to keep doing that.
Yeah, he's had, Carter Terry has not had a whole lot of time today to go through his reads and make the right passes. He's been kind of struggling to get through. Scott's kick is away. Wesleyan kind of bobbles it on the catch, but they're at the 15, 20. Brought down on the 23-yard line.
And you can hear that. Listen to Loris running off the field. They're all fired up. They're all screaming. They all went, oh, after the play. Versus Nebraska Wesleyan. They're walking with their heads down off the field. They look defeated right now. Loris is the exact opposite. They're amped up. They're fired up. Seeing some new defensive linemen in for the Duhawks here.
It looks like number 42, Milo Cola, has checked into the game. As well as number 98. As Josh Kiefer meets Myers in the backfield like a heat-seeking missile and brings him down.
You hear the Keith calls from the sideline. Yep, that's number 98, Emmett Finn.
Emmett Finn out of Rockford, Illinois.
Oh wow.
And Boylan Catholic.
Yeah, I wonder what high school he went to, huh? I wonder what middle school he went to, too. Not the same as me. I'm kidding. He went to the same middle school. Too. Good to see Emmett out there.
Terry and Myers in the backfield send their tight end in motion, looking for him in the flat. Not there. Terry's got nowhere to go, and he's brought down by number 42, Milo Kohler.
And oh, gonna, and he got a flag.
They're going to say excessive celebration.
I didn't think that was that much, really.
Coach Greg Bauer is not happy with him after that one,
nope.
Giving him an earful right now. You can hear Coach Bauer having some words of choice there.
Yep. He's mainly just telling them, celebrate with your teammates, not on your own. Good play right there. That was a kind of a coverage sack, though.
Mm-hmm.
And good, decent pressure, just no one was open.
Number 56, Jonah Clark, also in the game freshman. So Wesleyan moves the guy in motion. Terry dropping back. Good protection. Thrown over the middle. Picks up the first down and then some. Brought down by Joey Foley.
Yeah. Catch. Penalty's kind of a momentum killer.
Catch by Peyton Bartholomew. Shotgun formation here for the Prairie Wolves on first and 10. With 6:07 left to go here in the third quarter. Terry dropping back. Pressure immediately trying to get out of the pocket. Terry pulls it and runs. He's brought down after a first down.
Yeah, Kiefer looked like kind of had a free shot on him, but good job by Terry to avoid Kiefer. I know that's pretty hard to do.
Yeah, just good poise there by Terry. Pressured immediately and was able to keep his eyes downfield and find that hole and take off run for a first down.
Got the starting D-line back out there.
Pistol formation with Myers behind Terry. They send their two tight ends in motion to the left side. The first down snap, Terry going for a screen, little sidearm action as Joey Foley tries to blow up the play, but Myers is streaking down the sideline, one man to beat, and he beats him with the juke move, and they're going to give him a touchdown.
Wow, nice play there from Wesleyan. Nice little sidearm pass. If he would have thrown it regularly, it definitely would have been an incompletion or interception.
As you see the Nebraska Wesleyan fans right there on your screen, making the long trip from Lincoln, Nebraska, around a six-hour drive, coming out to support for their Prairie Wolves.
That's dedication right there.
Yeah, it is. As Nebraska Wesleyan fighting maybe back into this game. See what the Duhawks offense has to say after this extra point. Kick is up, and looks like it is good. Making that a 42-24 game as we look at the replay here. EJ, what do you see here?
Yeah, it's a screen pass. Looks like Phelps had to, but he put on the brakes. Mason just couldn't quite get there in time. Ended up in the end zone.
Yeah, it's the second time we've seen Myers kind of put those brakes on today, so definitely a good stop-and-go kind of running back.
Yep. And Justin in this game is looking like it's all over.
We got something to say about it.
Yeah, penalty, and they're right back in it. That penalty's tough, too. Milo, he did a little something, but
it was just a little bit of a
I didn't think it was too excessive.
It
yeah,
like.
It wasn't. Harrison is back there with Jace now.
So maybe giving Marty a little bit of a break from the kick returns?
I'd imagine so.
Interesting to see how the communication works back there between them. As Jace is going to take this one around the 15-yard line. He's at the 20, trying to cut back in. Looks like he's going to be, they're telling him to go down. Looks like he's around the 26-yard line. You see Jace Gwynn on your screen there, the defensive back, also return man.
Pretty good return right there by him.
As the Duhawk offense goes back out there with Jamal Britt behind Evan England in the backfield. You got Ty out wide at the bottom of your screen. Next to him is Monty Brown. And your two receivers at the top are, I'll tell you right after this, as they get a screen to Ty. Good block by Monty. Ty tried to bounce that one outside. The two receivers at the top of your screen were Jaheim Haynes and Dwayne Emulis on that last play. Same personnel out there again.
Interesting seeing Ty lined up out wide. Kind of do-it-all type
yeah.
player.
England hands it off to Britt. Britt's got a hole up the middle. Jamal Britt picking up the first down for the Duhawks.
Great run right there. He's just a hard runner, hard to bring down.
You can just see it in the way he runs, even from up here, the power that he has, and he brought down right away that time. But it looks like maybe Nebraska Wesleyan's warming up their backup quarterback, number 12, Evan Johnson, on the sideline.
Interesting.
It'll be interesting to see if he actually comes out. Handing off to Britt once again, bouncing to the outside. Meeting the safety, close to the first down marker. And he's going to pick up that first down.
Man, you better get out of his way or you're going to get ran over.
And Jamal's not a guy afraid of contact as they dump it out to him in the flat. He's going to cut it up. And, oh, down the sideline. And Jamal's,
they're going to probably call flags.
Holding. Looks like it'd be on number one, Dwayne, again. But Jamal looks kind of gassed out there a little bit on that run.
Two straight touches right there.
That's Dwayne's second holding call, I believe, in the past two drives, if it is on him. As you can hear the coaches talking to him, I believe that was the offensive coordinator, Jake Olson, telling him to
That was Powers.
On. Oh, it was Coach Powers?
Powers.
Oh, Powers.
Yep, he's the receivers coach. I think Olson is upstairs calling plays through Powers. And, yep. Saw Dwayne run off right there and Crawford out there to replace him.
Got Kelly and Pritchett back there, as well as Ty. Crawford, who just checked in the game, top of your screen. England dropping back. It's a screen play to Ty. Oh!
That was very dangerous.
If
right
Ty
there.
Was able to bring that one down, he had three linemen in front of him.
Three linemen and a whole bunch of open turf.
Looked like it was about one safety he had to beat.
Yeah. I was surprised Evan was able to get that over the defender, though. That was a risky pass.
Would have paid off big, though, if they would have got it. It's bringing up second down and 13 for the Duhawks. With 3:48 to go here in the third quarter. Duhawks are driving up to this point. England, nobody open, throwing it down the sideline, and Ty runs into the marker over there on the sideline. He's hurt.
Yeah, it looked like he ran right into the marker. That's no good.
I think the marker might be feeling it more than Ty, maybe.
It certainly looks like it. I don't know. Ty just
looks like he's holding his shoulder coming off.
Yeah.
Hopefully it's just a stinger.
Yeah, that marker, though. That just
the marker's in kind of bad shape.
It's in shambles.
Third and 12 still here for the Duhawks. England and Pritchett in backfield. Pritchett motions to England's right. England gets a snap. Three-step drop. Push up in the pocket. Thrown over the middle to McGovern. That pass is knocked away by number three, Ashton Kirkland, who we've been calling his name, seems like, all day.
Yeah, that's great play right there. Stepping up, getting your hands on the ball, knocking it away. Just like that. Don't call the game yet. Some choice words, I believe, from Sean Doyle, telling them to lock in just with a little more colorful language.
Glad you're here to interpret it, DJ.
Yeah.
As Driscoll
I speak football
again.
Player.
Driscoll's punt is up and took his time, but it's a good one. Receiving at the 15.
Yeah.
Going nowhere. Mason Morris tackling him.
Great tackle right there.
And our long snapper, number 30, Owen Patton, was also one of the first guys down there as well.
Love to see that. Let's see if they go back to the screen here.
I've been doing a lot of motion, so It'll be interesting to see here on as here's the punt and that tackle by Mason Morris. Just met him right away and went nowhere.
Just stuck him right away.
It's Terry and Myers in the backfield again. Motion over. That brings up Harris. Thrown over the middle. First down and then some. Jace Gwynn beat on coverage there by number 7 for the Prairie Wolves, Cole Symes.
See the Wesleyan crowd kind of getting back into it now.
Yeah, the Stewhawk defense just kind of seems flat right now almost. Seems
yeah.
Like, oh, maybe the whole team. Because it could start with maybe just the offense, then could transfer over to the defense.
Well, I think it started with the penalty, honestly. I think this is all where it started from.
Wesleyan on their own 36-yard line looking to drive here and make this game even more of a contest. Duwalks in a 3-4. Fakes the pass. Got the gain of 6 there to number 5, Matt Zarbinki.
He gets more pressure on the quarterback here this play.
Looks like Nebraska Wesleyan just checked in number 7, Cole Sims, and number 5, Matt Zarbinicki, as well as Trace Liners are their receivers out there. Bunched up top right with Myers in the backfield. Duwalks. Now looks like they're sending 4 guys. Terry, 4-step drop back. Nowhere to go.
Oh.
Breaks off one defender, but can't escape the second. Blaine Jordan with the sack.
Yeah, he was able to get away from Josh Kiefer, but Blaine Jordan's there to clean up the mess.
I believe
huge
it was,
play right there.
I believe
there.
It was Andrew Hafel.
Oh, was Hafel?
Yeah. Andrew Hafel missed him, and Blaine Jordan was there to clean up. Right there, as you see, Blaine Jordan just getting him by the foot and able to bring him down. Shotgun formation once again on 3rd and 11. Terry dropping back. Pressure to step up again. Trying to get away from the pressure, but he can't. Duhawks with a 2nd straight sack.
Hafel.
And Hafel cleaning up what he couldn't get last time. Andrew Hafel. The local debut kid went to Hempstead High School. Definitely played here when they had those cross-city rivalries against Wallard. So familiar with this field and able to not give up on the play and bring down Terry by a nice little arm tackle on the feet.
Yeah, good job working back to the football right there by Hafel.
The punt is up. It looks like McGovern's going to have to get it off the bounce or just let it bounce. Probably a smart play there.
Yep.
So it's going to be down at the Duhawk 24-yard line.
What a day for the Duhawk defense so far.
It was a great response by the defense after allowing that score to come out and not letting Nebraska Wesleyan go anywhere.
Probably 4 or 5 sacks, interception, fumble recovery for a touchdown.
Starting to hear a little bit more chatter on that sideline from the coaches, maybe. Starting to get a little louder. This is Jamal Britt back in at running back. England hands it off to Britt. Jamal looking for somewhere to go and gets about maybe a yard, if that.
Hey, stay patient. Bounce around, look for a hole. There's no opening right there.
Same personnel once again for the Duhawks. England fakes the run, looking to air it out deep to McGovern. He's got McGovern, and he finds him in the breadbasket for the catch.
What a throw, what a catch, what a play. Everyone assumed that the Duhawks probably just going to run it again, throw it down in the flat. Nope. Marty's wide open.
And that's the definition of putting the ball right in the breadbasket. Marty could have just held his hands and would have fell right in there as they're going to run on the read option, and Jamal Britt going nowhere.
Yeah, perfect throw. Great job to hang onto it by Marty.
As we look at that replay from the previous play, Evan knew right away who he wanted to throw the ball to, and he just fed it in there perfectly, wouldn't you say, EJ?
Yeah, it looked like Aaron Rodgers-esque right there. I know you're a Packer fan.
You've seen
that a lot.
I love seeing that.
But that was right in the breadbasket, and good job by Marty to hang on to the ball, defender right there, and fall into the ground.
And that's the second time that we have seen Evan England throw into tight coverage and complete it to Marty McGovern. And so definitely one of those receivers he trusts in a tight, you know, tight area to fit it into. So that's what you like to see.
Yeah, pretty good quarter overall right there for the Duhawks. The one penalty and screen pass, the only two negatives really. Mm-hmm. But defense got after him a lot. Offense looked pretty good, running the ball, getting KP in the end zone.
Oh, looks like the cheerleaders are throwing out some shirts that the fans are wanting. Getting them into it for this fourth quarter.
Up here. Up here. If they could throw it up here, they should be throwing some pads on.
Yeah. Oh, they got a slingshot.
Oh, that's awesome. Oh.
A little malfunction, as you can see on the screen.
Malfunction. Oh,
do it the old-fashioned way.
Yeah.
Oh, what a catch.
Lucky fan. One-hand snag right there.
Nothing like those Duhawk shirts. Best drip in the game.
Gotta love free merch.
If there's an extra clip there, grab it because the chain broke too.
Oh, it sounds like the chains broke?
Yeah, the chain. Just heard the ref say there's an extra clip, grab it because the chain's broke. Get some updates here on other scores, excuse me, across the ARC. Possibly. We have. Hold on. We are having technical difficulties right now at the website. Hold up 1 second. Oh, here we go. BV's up 30. Oh, wow, so they came back 39-28. That's a high-scoring game, exciting game there. 14-48 in the fourth. Coe's up 48-10 on Simpson. 8 left in the fourth. We got this game here. And I believe Wartburg is currently shutting out UD 25-0. So, some great games going across the ARC right now.
Yeah, and Wartburg is actually who the Duhawks have next week, and they're number 22 in the country right now. So, definitely that one is at Wartburg, though, so you have to tune into their stream to listen to it. But it's going to be one that you're not going to want to miss, especially after the Duhawks beat number 12 Central. And if everything holds up the way that's looking, the Duhawks will move to 2-0 in conference and 2-2 overall and have a two-game win streak going into Wartburg.
Yeah, it's a great start to conference season. That's all you can ask for going into Wartburg is be undefeated. At Wartburg, tough place to play. Wartburg, one of the powerhouses of this conference historically, them and Central. If you can take them down, you're in a great spot to win conference. But got to finish this one out first before we can look ahead.
Mm-hmm. If the Duhawks do start off maybe 3-0 in conference, you could look at them possibly winning conference for maybe the first time ever, I believe, right?
Yeah, they've never won conference, but they also have to get that monkey off their back and the fact that they got to go beat Wartburg at Wartburg, which I'm not quite
sure.
It's not
easy.
Yeah, very few teams do that. Central and Wartburg usually are the only teams who could beat each other in their own home turf, but not this year.
As we're still waiting for the chain to get fixed here. And EJ, what would you say have been the keys to the Duhawks being ahead so far going into this fourth quarter?
Let England eat. Okay. Let that man cook. Let him do what he's going to do. Let him get in space. Let him keep his eyes down the field. If no one's open, he'll run for the first down. If not, he will drop a dot in Marty McGovern's hand or a wide open Monty Brown. get the ball out to the flat. He makes smart decisions and fast decisions. You got to love that about him.
So who would you say, as of right now, would be your player of the game? Or players of the game?
Players? All right. Offense, England, Ty, and Monty all are up there, I would say. Hard to pick between those three. Marty also having a great game. You know, he's returning kicks and punts, too, so you got to give him that, too. Defensively, Kiefer's been all over the place. Mason's been all over the place. Joey had the pick. Jace is a couple pass breakups. So I don't know if necessarily one person stands out on the defense. It's more been a cohesive group effort. Blaine, Sean Doyle, everyone's in the backfield.
Definitely has been a fun one to watch so far. And hopefully we're getting back into action here. As you hear the, I believe that's also EJ doing the Jeopardy, but the Dolores band, pep band kind of sounds like it's out there too. You hear the trumpet.
And we're back and ready to roll.
Back in action is 2nd and 10 here for the Duhawks.
Wonder if Ty running into that marker had anything to do with it.
Yeah. As the sun has came out and the official blew the whistle pre-snap.
That play looked like it was going to be money, too. Coach Olsen, nice to mixing trick plays every now and then. So, especially in the fourth quarter of a game like this, don't be surprised if we see a running back or a receiver throw a pass.
Maybe see something that could work out later in the year for when you really, you know, could be struggling to put something on the board and you got to go deep into the bag. England, Bausch in the backfield. Ty gets it. Picks up a nice gain around 6 yards, keeping those legs turning.
Ty just needs a couple more yards, get to that 100-yard mark.
For number 21, Ty Bausch, captain of the 36.
Along with probably around 10 yards, 20 yards receiving. A couple touchdowns.
He's doing it all today.
D3 Christian McCaffrey.
England drops back, looking to throw it deep. And he finds Jaheim Haynes on the sideline. Fitting it in yet another tight area.
Between two defenders. Nice catch by Jaheim, making sure he gets 1 foot in as well.
And actually, EJ, I think we just got the x-rays back from Evan England. And he's got that dog in him.
I can't confirm he has that dog in him.
You saw on the replay there, just that beautiful throw he has. He's going to throw it again.
There's a penalty.
That was almost intercepted. Looking to throw it to Harrison Willis, I believe.
See what the flag is here.
As you, I believe, was that Coach H?
I think that might have been. Maybe. I'm not sure if that was Coach H. Might have been Nebraska Wesleyan's coach.
Harrison? He said it was an illegal man downfield?
Yeah, I don't understand that.
Evan's stats so far in the game, 21 of 33, 275 yards with one passing touchdown and one rushing touchdown. So he is having himself a day. And Monty Brown has over half of those receiving yards as well. As Ty gets it on the outside, runs over the Nebraska Wesleyan defender number 2, Kaju Adepoko.
You better hop on the bus or get out of the way when Ty's coming through because he's going to run you over.
Yeah. England gets the snap, hands it off to pass, and I'm going to say it's a fumble. I think he threw that ball forward is what the discussion is going to be right now.
I believe the call on the field was a fumble, though, but the lower sideline is pleading that it is the pass, and they rule it is a fumble. And Wesleyan ball.
So the first hiccup that Evan England has had today comes in the fourth quarter on the QB option keeper.
He had no time. He can throw back.
I don't know. It looked like his arm was going forward, but yeah. Nebraska Wesleyan defender was already on him when it was going forward, so that could have been.
Yeah, he was there by the time Evan was bringing his arm back to throw the ball before he can even get it to throw forward. So not much of an argument there for the Duhawks.
Nebraska Wesleyan trying to get something going here. Nothing's going at all for him as the Duhawk defense remains stone cold.
I believe that was Jonah in there on the tackle. First time we've called his name. Making the play out there today.
Damani Brown with 110 yards receiving in this game. Marty McGovern with 71. So Duhawks almost with two receivers in the 100-yard mark. Two running backs in the backfield with Terry. One on his left, one on his right. He gets the snap. Three-step drop, looking for his man. He's got him after a good amount of time in the pocket. Finds number 39, Nathan Manarek.
Joey Foley with a good hit right there. But it looks like he needed one right there as Jace comes in. Looks like Chris Cam is going to be looking at Joey's shoulder right there. As I believe the official diagnosis was a torn rotator cuff for Joey.
Oh, that is extremely painful.
Yeah.
So definitely showing a lot of determination playing through that. Is he? Do you know if he's playing with any of like a shoulder harness?
I would have to imagine so. He's last week he's wearing one around the house a lot. So
Terry with the three-step drop gets to his running back in the flat. Mike Barber with the tackle.
Big tackle right there. Wasn't many people behind him. Looked like he'd been able to run for a while, if not all the way into the other end zone.
And that's what you want those cornerbacks on the outside to do, is keep that contained, make those saving tackles. Because I think Mike Barber was honestly the only guy on that side to make that
yeah.
play.
You know what they say about Mike Barber?
What?
He's a playmaker.
Oh. I can see our play stopper,
yeah.
if you will.
Yeah.
Three receivers at the bottom of your screen. Duhawks send four. Terry pushed out of the pocket, trying to make something happen. Throwing it deep into Mike Barber's coverage. And that ball incomplete. That was intended for Trace Lenners.
Great coverage right there. Not the best pressure ever from the Duhawks. Kind of gave him some time to take his time back there, but just nothing open. Mike the Barber, Chase.
Yeah, and Carter Terry, I think he's just kind of getting a little skittish back there. Gets a little nervous when he's been in the pocket, almost seems like a long time, because he's been kind of pushed out a lot.
Yeah.
Number 15 in the backfield, Grant Snelling for Nebraska Wesleyan. As they drop back, looking to throw it. That's going to be incomplete. No flags.
A little too high for the receiver right there. The punt team is coming on out.
Nebraska Wesleyan not going anywhere after that turnover, which I'm sure is something they're going to want to fix. With only 11:23 left, every possession counts, especially if you take the ball away from the Duhawks in their own red zone.
Yeah, got to capitalize on that.
Marty McGovern back to receive the kick. High snap.
Oh.
He had to rush forward to avoid a block. Marty's just going to let that one bounce. Almost thought that he's going to run and keep it for a second, but Duhawks had good pressure, like you said, they've had all game on those kicks.
Yeah. Great pressure once again. I thought they were going to be able to block that one. The puncher with a little pause, kind of fake dusting out, looked like. Does your face truly show it? That you're happy, Hugh?
Yeah, the trumpet's doing a great job. I think a lot of these Duhawk fans are happy with what the result has been so far in this game. And in the past two games. England hands off to Pritchett. KP trying to hit that hole. And Nebraska Wesleyan defender, number 44, Caleb Kai, slowing him down, grabbing his ankle. And something that we discussed in one of our classes leading up into this game was the Duhawks kind of being sort of hot and cold, starting up 0-2, and then coming in number 12 Central and being Central. But, you know, those first two games are some that I'm sure the Duhawks think they should have won, especially
yeah.
against Eau Claire, only losing by a field goal.
Yeah, that game was tough. They had it in hand. Speaking of having the hand, Monty just had to go right through his hands
by Monty Brown.
Almost should have been picked, too. But, yeah, against Benedictine. Benedictine, similar offense to Wesleyan. They really like to swing the ball. Their quarterback looked really good. He's going to be a Gagliari finalist this year probably for sure. Eau Claire, man, that was just tough. No way we should have lost that game. Absolutely no way around it. But
I believe there was a missed field goal in that game as well towards the end.
Yep, last second touchdown by Eau Claire, too. It was tough, but Duox responded. They beat the Dutch. It looked great today.
Mm-hmm.
That's how you respond to those first two bad games.
England, quick drop back, getting out to Pritchett in the backfield on third down. And Duox going to lose a yard.
Good job right there by TJ Roy Bell, seeing the running back coming out or out the backfield right away. He's right on it. But a loss of two.
Driscoll coming back out for another punt.
Special teams player of the week right here.
Yeah, especially for a freshman to hit a game winner against number 12. It takes a certain level of confidence and clutchness that it's kind of hard to teach that you just kind of have. Schussel gets the punt off a little quicker here than his past couple ones. Looks like he's going to fair catch that one at his own 32-yard line.
Defense goes back on out there.
Defense has been busy in the second half so far. Offense, I believe, only two touchdowns so far in the second half. So definitely something that defense been out there a lot more. So probably going to maybe see some legs getting tired or maybe even have a couple second stringers going
there
and fill in.
Get some more fresh bodies in there.
Terry Myers in backfield. We hear Terry checking the offensive line. As Mason Morris, as you can hear Mason Morris meeting Myers in the back.
Oh, and a fumble! And they came away with it.
Are they going to say
I said he's down.
I don't know if we have a replay of that or not, so. As you see here on the replay, That's a fumble.
That's a fumble. Not even close. Not even close.
As they're airing it out now. And
He even threw it way over Bauer's head.
No intentional grounding then?
Yeah, I don't know. Well, yeah, no. That was clear as day, a fumble. Yeah.
As our sideline camera operator down there, Dylan Irvin, is getting into it, clapping his hands out there after our defensive performance. Terry Myers in the backfield. Terry pushed up in the pocket. Force a ball.
Mike Barber. He's a playmaker.
He is that dude. He's got a little bit of swag to him as well with the hoodie out.
Yep.
As you see here, this play, Mike just making a great play and kind of forcing. Terry's kind of forcing that ball and threw it a little behind him, and Mike able to jump up and break that pass up.
Another punt here from Wesleyan. Ty back there now.
Duox jumped off sides, and Ty's just going to let that one bounce back. After a punt like that, do you think they'll just decline the offsides because it's only 5 yards, right?
Might as well, yeah, unless they want to go for it. I didn't know.
I didn't know you could do that.
Yeah.
So Duhawks are even in a worse position here after that punt.
See if you get a nice 9 minute.
Nice 9 minute drive here.
96
yards.
Yeah.
97 yards.
Maybe just throw a screen to number 81 in the first play and might take it to the house.
Crawford. Handed it off here. to tie going nowhere. The center, number 62, Connor Durdan, kind of lost his battle there after that snap.
I want to give Connor Durdan a shout-out. Came in to college. He's going to be a tight end. Wasn't super happy. They moved him to O-line's freshman year, but he has worked his butt off to get there. And look at where he is, starting center on a team that beat Central. Probably 2-0 in conference. Hopefully everything goes to plan the rest of this game.
Evan gets the snap. Hands off to Ty. Ty looks like the same exact play as last time, almost going nowhere. It looks like number 79 for the Duhawks is slow to get up. Mitchell Husenga.
Housingay. That's a tough one. I wouldn't know how to say that if I didn't have him in class.
You see the offensive line there. Left tackle, Big Sean Corgulis. And a great left tackle at that as well. He's a good blindside protector for Evan. As Evan tries to get out to Crawford for the first down, and he does.
There we go. Let's keep this drive going. Let's keep the ball out of Lesnian's hand for at least like three more minutes.
You think if Duhawks score here and they get back out on offense that
it'd be
the
Hutch.
First guys will be?
I would be surprised if offensive line would probably be the only spot where there wouldn't be many changes.
Evan dropping back, looking to air it out to Crawford, and looks like there may be on a little bit of a miscommunication there. Crawford kind of slowed up after his first initial move.
He had him, though, yeah.
It was a good idea on both parts. They were wide open.
Just a little off, yep.
This tie's checking out for Jamal Britt. Been a good 1-2 combo all day. England and Britt, two sophomores side by side in the backfield. England QB draw, bounce out to the outside. Britt trying to lay a block, and Evan knocked out of bounds by number one for the Prairie Wolves, Correll Simpson.
Those always scare me this late in the game. Just having your quarterback running, taking a hit, and thank God he's able to get out of bounds and not get touched.
Picked up the first down, Duhawks on their own 26.
QB draw. It's been very effective today.
So getting the play call in here. Crawford, the receiver at the top of your screen. England dropping back. Got all day. Gets it to Marty McGovern. Marty making the guy miss. Second defender bringing him down. That was number 44, Caleb Kies. For Nebraska Wesleyan, bringing up second down and six. You see right here the replay. Evan, plenty of time. He's able to go through his progressions because the offensive line has just been great all day, EJ.
Yeah, they've been really good today. Looks like that one might even got tipped, but still got to this guy.
England hands it off to Jamal. Jamal reading the good holes there and getting close to the first down. Looks like they're about a yard short. Bringing up third and one.
I think you gotta give it to him again right here.
Or maybe see another QB sneak here. But that's been the only time that Loris has gone under center is the QB sneak, so definitely probably be almost a dead giveaway.
Yeah.
England gets a screen out to Monty Brown. Monty's got blockers. He's got a first down. He's gonna step out of bounds before he can be hit by number 18, Jacob Garman.
Monty Brown, I think he's going to break records here at Loris. He's only a sophomore, and he's already this good.
Mm-hmm. He had a great freshman year, and he's just building off that this year.
And England's only a sophomore. They got two more years to go. Man, great things ahead for this future, this Duhawk program.
As you see the screen, good blocks and good read by Monty Brown to get through that. Yeah, and coming into this game, as England drops back again, I believe that was Jaheim Haynes, number 13, who's having himself a day as well.
Wow. What a great game here for the Loris Duhawks.
Yeah, and going into this game, Damani already had 275 yards receiving, averaging 91.67 a game, and he's almost at 150 now. So
wow.
That's just improving the season he's having. and shows how much England likes to go to him as they hand it off to Brett here. He goes nowhere.
Uh-oh. Can't see who that is. You can hear Coach Bauer there on the sideline telling all the young guys on the defense to be ready to go in.
As we still can't see who the Duhawk is, that is down. It almost might be, looks like number 67. Yeah, Titus Mullins, the sophomore.
It's good he's able to walk off under his own power. Looked like a leg injury, so it's always really scary, especially for one of the linemen.
Yeah. And do most linemen, even if they haven't had knee injuries before, do they usually also wear those knee braces?
Yeah, more times than not, they'll wear knee braces because it's safer, it's smarter, too. It better be safe than sorry. You know, those guys are taking they're taking on the other biggest guys on the field every play. They're running out in space trying to block the smaller guys. It's a tough job, thankless job most of the time.
Britt motions to England's right. Another QB draw.
Nothing there.
Nebraska Wesleyan was all over it that time. Bringing up 3rd and 7 here for the Duhawks with 4 minutes and 50 seconds left to go here in the game.
Good drive here for the Duhawks. Obviously, you'd like to get in the end zone, but I think the ultimate goal here is just to chew up a bunch of that clock.
Maybe run some plays with maybe some different personnel, see what you like, possibly. As England gets it to Monty Brown, who falls down short of the sticks. And do you think Duhawks are going to go for it?
Oh, they gave it to him.
Oh, they did give it to him. From this angle, it looked like he was a couple yards short.
Yeah, I think they probably would have gone for it, though, if they didn't get it. Just probably QB sneak it or give it to Jamel. See the replay here. He's just open all the time.
Yeah.
He's allergic to being covered.
It's interesting how they kind of not really press coverage him either, kind of giving him the 5-yard give.
Yeah, you don't want to do that. Well, but then if you press cover him, you don't have help. That's recipe for 85-yard touchdown.
That's true. England kind of bobbles the snap, gets out to Dwayne. Dwayne met by 2 Prairie Wolves. But how often when receivers get press covered that there's usually not a safety over top that'll drift over maybe?
Yeah, I feel like most of the time it's going to be there. Or at least they're going to have someone show and then go away towards the end. But they're not, especially a guy like Monty or a guy like Marty, it's one of your better receivers. They're not going to do it. If it's one of the guys you think they're weaker receivers, you might see.
As you saw there on that play, Evan showed good composure after bobbling the snap. As this time he hands it off to Ty. Ty, still on his feet, picking up the first down and then some.
Great run.
Getting it within the 10. Looks like he's going to be spotted at the 7-yard line. Ty's hunting for that second touchdown of his rushing for the game.
Third. Yeah.
Pistol formation here for the Duhawks. Going to hand it off to Ty. Ty trying to hit the hole. Oh, keeps running.
Ran over 2 guys.
Rumbling,
right there.
Bumbling, stumbling. You're hearing 2 receivers. See some good sportsmanship there by both teams, helping each other up.
Got a new lineman coming in as well. Number 54.
Tyson Smith.
Oh, let's go.
6'4", 280-pound sophomore out of Morrison, Illinois. 2 running backs in the game here for the Duhawks. Monty Brown, the receiver at the bottom of your screen. Michael Crawford, the one up top. They hand it off to Ty. Ty bounces it to the outside. Makes a man miss and gets in for the touchdown. Ty with another touchdown and having himself a game. Looking a little tired there, but, you know, when you smell that end zone, that gives you a little bit more energy.
Yeah, he's tired. Yeah, look at him. He's like, woo, finally.
Get him the oxygen tank out there.
Third touchdown of the day for Ty. Let's go. Over 100 yards on the ground. England's probably around just under 300 yards. Monty's close to 200. Marty close to 100. What a day for the offense.
Scott's kick is up, and it is good. Scott remaining perfect on the day with his extra points. Some good confidence to have there.
Besides these young guys out here on the field now.
Yeah, and Evan's quarterback rating right now is 144.2 as well.
Wow.
He's got 331 pass yards. And he's kind of spread the wealth out, throwing to four receivers, three of them having five targets or more. I mean, five receptions or more, excuse me.
Gotta love that.
With Damani Brown having 133 of the 331 receiving yards.
Marty and Jaheim both 65-plus yards.
And the rushing yards ties at 119. So almost at the 120-yard mark rushing, which is an excellent number to be at.
What a day.
Scott line up to kick it once again today. This kick is off and away, and Bresk Wesen going to try and return this one. He's at the 20. He's at the 25, and looks like he falls forward to the 26-yard line.
Oh, yeah, we got a whole bunch of new guys running in. We got Michael Mixon. Yeah, that one's pretty clear.
Yeah, he was holding him on his way. And 10 receiver was number 89, Jonah Eichson, a junior out of Colorado Springs.
Probably a good pass interference. It might have been six if he didn't do it.
And with this being college, it's, as you see the replay here, that's a good ball. And, yeah, that's all he could do was hold him for the Duhawks. And with college, if you're beat, you almost kind of, instead of the NFL where you're beat, you just kind of want to almost take the pass interference because it's 15 yards instead of a spot of the foul, yep. Or if you're just getting absolutely burnt. It'll be interesting to see how Zacchaeus handles this play here, as it's almost like he was targeted a few times during that Central game. It's almost like they're kind of thrown at the guys he was guarding.
Yeah. Yeah, it seemed like they're kind of going at him a little bit towards the end of the game here, or last week. Excuse me.
He's at the bottom of your screen here. A little bit of a size mismatch. Johnson thrown to the left side of the field. Sanchez with the tackle.
Good tackle.
Johnson's pass complete.
Johnson to Johnson.
Yeah. Johnson, three-step drop back, looking to air it out. Hit as he throws it.
What? I don't know if I've ever seen that.
Dustin Harris not able to bring that one in. And as you see the replay here, Johnson lit as he throws it, and Harris is unable to catch it.
And he didn't know where the ball was after it hit off his
good
hands.
Good poise by Nathan Lindsay to catch it. Johnson throws it again, and they're going to get a touchdown here. Number 89. Jonah Eichson, the junior from Colorado Springs, is getting a touchdown here.
Yeah, wide open in the back of the end zone. I'm still shook by that last. Like, he got smoked, and then Dustin almost had a pick, and then.
Do you think Dustin having to play with that club on could have came a factor into
that
play?
First thing I thought of, honestly, was that right there, because he isn't able to squeeze with that hand or even really pin with that hand or arm.
Kick is up. Looks like it was right down the middle for Nebraska Wesleyan. As the Duhawk kicking team and special teams will get back out there, and I'm trying to see who it looks like the Duhawks are going to send out there at quarterback.
There's a minute left, so I wouldn't be surprised if they just take a couple knees.
Oh, and it won't be Evan taking those knees as he's got the green jersey on with the green ball cap on. His day's done, and he's had himself a game where he should be able to just relax this last minute.
Yep.
Do quarterbacks, you know, they had a good game. Do some of them just like to be out there for the final knee to kind of signify the victory?
Yeah. Yeah, a lot of times they get – they're the ones that are getting all the reps for knees in practice. You know, you don't really practice knees that much other than, like, the Friday pregame practice, and you don't really have anyone else out there besides your number one guy. But I'm sure Hutch has plenty of experience.
Yeah.
And we'll see. Maybe they want to get some young guys some more touches. Yeah. They might not even want to knee it.
Garrett Hutchinson, the 5'11", 205-pound junior out of Des Moines, Iowa, went to Roosevelt High School. As they try an onside kick here, and
take it to the house!
Take it to the crib!
Go!
On an onside kick!
Oh.
He brought down just short of the end zone at the 11-yard line. It looks like that was number 26, Zach Kemp.
What a play. What a smart play right there.
As you can see on the replay here, just a heads-up play. And that would have been something if he was able to take that back.
That he put on the brakes, too. Wow.
As Garrett Hutchinson is going to be the quarterback here for the Duhawks with 55.5 to go here in the game.
I seriously doubt they're going to knee it now.
Yeah, especially after that.
Since if they would have kicked it off normally, probably would have been a knee, but the onside.
Looks like they have Ty out there as well at running back, which kind of surprises me.
Yeah, maybe they want him to get four?
That'd be something.
That's what it looks like.
They hand it off to Ty. He's brought down right away as you hear calls for a horse collar.
I would be careful having Ty still out here, though. He's a running back. He's taken a lot of hits over the years. Don't want him to get hurt.
And it could get a little chippy, too, here towards the end.
Oh, and he just got pulled out. So KP's in there for him now.
Pritchett in the backfield with Hutchinson. They hand off to Pritchett. Pritchett hitting the hole hard. Staying on his feet. Brought down short of the end zone inside the 5-yard line.
Looks like Ty's would be tied for seventh right now, single game rushing touchdowns. You got everything.
Starting to get loud as the bench is getting the crowd hype.
Last play of the game.
And Pritchett is going to be short of the end zone. And that is your ball game. Your Loras College Duhawks 49, Nebraska Wesleyan Prairie Wolves 31, and the Duhawks move to 2-0 in conference and two games in a row that they have won. And this one almost maybe a statement win, saying that game might not have been a fluke against Central.
Nope, that's a major statement win coming against a team that you know you're better than. You go out here and you show them that you're better.
Yeah, and that's just huge. And like we said, especially with the game next week at number 22 Wartburg, first game of October. It's going to want to be one that you guys are going to want to watch on Warburg's end of the live stream. I believe it's the Nightcast. So, EJ, great game. And what do you think the Duhawks can improve on? Because I feel like there's always stuff you can improve
on. Yeah, just there's a couple dumb penalties, you know, a lot of stuff after the play. We can't have that going against Warburg, a great team next week at Warburg. Especially, they're not going to give us anything. They're not going to give us those penalties, so we cannot afford to give them to them. Got to be sure-handed on the punts and the kicks. Other than that, just got to keep up what we're doing, I would say.
Yeah, and looks like we'll be drawing an end to this one for the first week of Loras College Duhawks football. I'm Hugh Maloney, signing off for EJ Greenberg. Thanks for watching, everybody.
Peace.